Yeah. This is my song to the Most High, who created all life on earth, like the birds that fly, the sweet air we breathe, all the plants and trees, the sun, and they planted in the galaxy. Yo, they feeding us bullshit with all these books. We didn't ask to be here, we got took, enslaved and killed. We was raped and hung, we was lied to and forced to build America, robbed of our technology and knowledge of self.
Born in 1932 to a poor family, Dick Gregory got picked on a lot. He started telling jokes about himself to get the kids to laugh with him and not at him. When Dick Gregory first started out as a comedian, he performed primarily at black nightclubs. He began his professional career in 1958 as a master of ceremonies at several Chicago nightclubs. While performing one night for the Playboy Club in Chicago, he earned a profile in Time magazine. He even appeared on The Tonight Show. Dick Gregory gained his fame as a comedian for his satirical views on American racial attitudes.
When you stop and think, football is a fair sport for my people. Only sport in the world, a Negro can chase a white man and 40,000 people stand up and cheer. I found out that cold weather makes it very nice for race relations. Last month, when it was 15 below zero in Chicago, I walked out of a nightclub, a drunk walked up to me, and said, "Why don't you get back to Africa where you belong and take me with you?"
Racial tensions were high around this time, and he was an active member of the civil rights movement. Dick Gregory had the performance skills to convey racial material to both white and black audiences without offending either, especially his political messages about the civil rights movement.
Are you a good audience tonight, and treat me nice, because with President Kennedy's new housing bill, I might be your neighbor now.
But everybody's busy. They say, "Well, let's keep the racial issue out of politics." And Barry Goldwater, Lyndon Johnson met for 13 minutes and solved the racial problem. That's not enough time to solve the racial problem in Gooseneck, Nebraska, and they just got one color cat living there.
Dick Gregory became one of the first black comedians to perform political humor for white audiences. Once again, he was able to get integrated audiences to laugh with him and not at him.
And I'm so glad this bugging has finally come out, because now people are believing. You know, for one night I was on one of those nationwide television talk shows, right? So I mentioned the fact on the show, "I don't know why the government bugs my phone." Guy got very uptight. He said, "Dick Gregory, I defy you to get on a nationwide television show and accuse the United States government of bugging your phone. What evidence do you have?" I said, "I've got the evidence." He said, "Well, what is it?" I said, "Anytime a black cat in America can old Bell telephone $12,000 and they don't cut the phone off, it's tapped."
Dick Gregory changed the way white Americans perceived African-American comedians. They finally accepted that a black man could intelligently make jokes about politics and race without being confrontational.
And we're making progress. 20 years ago, the light-complected Negro had it made. Today, it's the dark-complected Negro, simply because of government contracts. In order for big business to get good government contracts today, they have to hire Negro and white on an equal basis. So they go out and get the blackest cat they can find. So when that government inspector walks in that plant, he can see him 7 blocks away. "Well, you got one, darn right, we had one."
"But know when you get no, when you go in a restaurant and order a 3-minute egg and they make you pay in advance. When you really know you get no is when your lady or your man yell upset, 'Run upstairs and let's have some sex,' and you yell back, 'You know I can just do one or the other.'" How many of y'all in the audience is aware that about 61% of those folks who make those phone calls for collection are prison inmates? How many of y'all know that?
Wow.
And they make 31 cents an hour.
Wow. Okay.
So I got some triple serial killer calling me the other day. "You know you're late with Neiman Marcus." I say, "Punk, you come get the money."
"And I'm just getting warm, just like Muhammad Ali. Thank God. Mama said knock you out. I'm gonna knock you out. Mama said knock you out."
Now, I know some brothers will go in and shoot their mama, but they ain't gonna shoot theyself. You know what I'm saying? And he must have been a good shot. He shot the doctor's still alive. He shot his mom himself, they dead. What kind of gun did you have? In the hood. But we don't live in no community. A hood is something you wear over your to hide something, right? A community, you control your cops, you control your banks, you control your education. You don't, none of y'all do that. And then you wonder what's wrong with the children? You. So the Secret Service called me and says, Mr. Gregory, you are on President-elect Obama's VIP list for the inauguration. Where can we pick you up? So I get into my dumb bag. Is y'all the same Secret Service that was in Dallas with JFK when he got shot? See, you got to stop letting people validate you. You see them two white folks that slipped in Obama's dinner? You can slip in heaven easier than you can the White House. They were sending him a message. We can take you out anytime. You sure they ain't been to jail? If you sneak in the post office and go behind the counter, you can go to jail. They slipped in the White House, and didn't get caught. They went home that night and Googled and said, let me tell you what we did. That's so he will know anytime we get ready to take you out. We can take you out. Condoleezza Rice, she had more PhDs than Bush's whole cabinet. They called her Condi. Never doctor. Never called Madeleine Albright Maddie. Never called Janet Reno Janet. I saw Condoleezza Rice one day. She said, why you always be talking about me? I said, because they don't give you proper respect. They call you Condi. They got a black soda pop blacker than you. They call Dr. Pepper. King James was king of England. He was such a weird homosexual. He hated women so bad, he killed his mama. I mean, y'all know that. And his lover was Lord Buckingham, who Buckingham Palace is named after. So now once you check him out and know how he feel about women, then you know why you come out so bad in the book. I'm going to Victoria's Secret. You know about Victoria's Secret. Have you ever asked yourself why will you buy your drawers is called secret? Because Queen Victoria was a man. Okay? You knew that. You ever seen this picture, that old ugly thing? Yeah. So if I'm a man faking like I'm a queen, I got to wear women's drawers. So that's why the name of the store is Victoria's Secret. What is Victoria's Secret? See, you don't have to be too smart to figure out stuff. Just stop being dumb. Okay? You understand what I'm saying? He loved y'all, right? He paid me to come over. I ain't come over here for free. Now I don't charge him what I charge white folks. And he brought some rappers in here calling y'all bitches and hoes.
he'd have a line standing on him. All he wanted to do was give you information. Information. And he got tapes out there he's selling. Information. Money is not power. Education is not power. Information is power. If I give you bad information, you got bad power. Got y'all crazy. Look, if I own the biggest bank in town, and me and you are friends, you know what I mean? Wouldn't you be stupid to come to the bank and ask me to borrow a quarter? Huh? You know what I'm saying? You gonna come, it costs you a dollar to get on the subway to come ask me for a quarter. You know what I mean? We friends, man. So the most I can do is tell you no, then you go tell your friends. So I went in the bank, the nigga's worth about $40 billion. I asked, and he said no. You understand? What I mean by that, how can y'all, you know, God controls the whole universe. Ain't nothing in the universe that the real God didn't put there, right? So why would you pray to God for a job when he owned everything? Huh? Just ask for the money. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? We ain't talking about no chumps. We talking about the real God. And you're going to fall on your knees and waste that time asking God for a job. That means you don't believe in God. If you believe in God, you just say, why would you pray to God because your rent due? You think God don't know that? Huh? You just say, hey, fix it, champ. That's all. But y'all go through all that craziness, huh? But we get mad, my wife all upset over debt. And I said, I don't know what you're upset over. You know I didn't have nothing when you married me. I didn't even know if I wanted to be a comedian or not. I just knew I didn't want to work. Huh? And I noticed that all the people that run this planet don't work. That kind of scary. Prince Charles, one of the richest white boys on the planet. You got more intelligence in your baby finger than that boy got in his whole body. And he ain't never had a job. Why? Because nobody told him he needed one. Huh? Y'all got a zoo here in town? Other than John Hopkins. No, y'all got a zoo here? Yeah. All right, you need to go there. They got a gorilla out there. You need to go there and just, you know, don't go like you want to look at the gorilla. Just go and just kind of, and the gorilla be looking at you, see? Brother, I ain't different. Huh? But before you go out there, if you're working, take off a week, because gorillas can smell if you got a job, and they don't like you. And just watch the gorilla. The gorilla eat more food in one day than you eat in 6 months, and the gorilla ain't never had a job. Have you ever read where a gorilla starved to death?
No.
You ever read where a gorilla robbed somebody?
No.
Rape somebody?
No.
Commit suicide?
No.
See, work will make you do all that. At least if you're going to be stupid enough to believe you need a job, why don't you let work find you? Huh? And when you see it come, hide from it. Queen Elizabeth make $360 million every 24 hours just interest on her money. Hmm? Now them bees white folks. Huh? I like them type of white folks because they ain't honest, they ain't nothing but
thugs, they ungodly, unspiritual, but they tell the truth. They say, we going to war to protect our interests. As an interest. You know what I'm saying? And so when you stop and think about, you know, the games they play. So I wouldn't even know how to perk my mouth up to ask God for a job. I mean, this is the real, you know, there's trillions of stars in the sky. God put them all there. Now, I might ask God for a couple of stars. Piece of moon. Damn fools grow wild. You ever walk out in the forest, this food is growing? And they got you believing you got to work to eat? So somewhere. And then after you get it, they trick you. Look at Tiger Woods. Damn near a billionaire. And you had a better Thanksgiving last year than he did. He sent me a Christmas card. And I was waiting for a New Year's card. Because the Christmas card kind of insulted me because he didn't tell me the truth. Here's the Christmas card. It said, ho, 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 ho. And he left 18 of them hoes off. I mean, here's a boy so messed up. Then he messed it up for all of us. You know what I mean? Every woman on the planet could make her some money saying she had sex with Tiger, except you, because he didn't fool with no sisters. You know what I'm saying? And then did y'all buy what they told you? His wife beat him up. Now think about what they saying. Wife ain't never been to school. She was a nanny for his good friend, who her and his wife and the nanny probably got together and said, let's trick you. So she said she heard some noise. Now, Shaq lives in that same complex. And them houses are so far away from the road, you couldn't hear nothing. If World War III was going up, you wouldn't hear nothing. So she said she runs down. Y'all know the story, right? And he laying out there on the ground in the car, unconscious. So she runs back to the house. Instead of getting the other set of keys, she get a golf stick. Did you see the car? Now, if this is your husband and he on the left side of the car, then why would you go to the back of an SUV and break the back window out when he up front? And you see the picture? The glass was shattered, all of it come out. So how she crawled through there without getting cut? And then they carried him to the hospital. And then for the next 3 days, the Florida State Troops was trying to interview him. Y'all saw that. And he wouldn't let him. Do you realize how racist Florida is? And do you realize what a Florida State Trooper is like? And here's a brother done took over their game and their white woman. And this nigga gonna tell them, I don't wanna talk to you. And they didn't have to have no reason. Did y'all know he was driving barefooted in a pair of short pants? Did y'all know that? How many of y'all know that? Do you know in the 50 states of America, it is against the law to drive with no shoes on? So that alone, give him a right to go in and question him, huh? So I know a friend of mine who knows somebody that worked in the hospital where they brought him. And so I called a friend of mine, which was my daughter, and she said, the chief of nurses want to send you a picture of him, but if she didn't say who it was, you wouldn't recognize him. That's how bad he was beat. So I said, no, I don't need that. I always knew when they said it was, that was a mob whooping. That was a mob whooping. And if you want to trace the blame back other than him, not them hoes, Charles Barkley. And who? Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan broke. Michael Jordan ain't got a qualm. How many of y'all know that Michael Jackson owns 50% of Sony? How many of y'all know that? And if they sold it right now, he would get about $80 billion. But they told you he was broke. And what difference do it make? You ain't going to get nothing anyway from him. But Michael Jordan ain't got a quarter. And they tell you he got all this money. Gambling. Gambling. And then when they found out Michael Jordan was shaving points, I mean, y'all know that. See, y'all both know everything. Y'all know that. Nobody in the room know. They was investigating it. And in the process of investigating it, they found out that Magic was saving points. So the white folks say, oh, we got to find a way to stop this investigation.
Of course, they are basketball. So they said, Magic, you tell me you got it.
Magic ain't lost no weight. He ain't look sick. And if he had AIDS and cured it, how come you think all these rich gays that's dying from it don't be the path to him and say, how'd you do it? Huh? And Michael, they killed his daddy. And they gave him a reason to get out. So y'all shouldn't even be sticking your nose in business when you don't know nothing about it. They found Michael's daddy in the car, right? Shot in the aorta. Huh? How far you live from here? 20 miles. So if you get shot in the aorta, blood will splash all the way back to your house. But yet there was no blood in the car. So that gave Michael and Magic a reason to get out, and the investigation stops. Then Magic was going to come back in, and the guy said, no, man, we don't want to be playing where you can get cut in that AIDS blood, y'all know, so that he couldn't come back in. So they told Michael to make like you want to play baseball. Remember that? That was to keep him in shape. Then he came on back in. It's a game. And do y'all know how treacherous these people are? about 40 to 60% of your college football game is fixed. Huh? The favorite in the Kentucky Derby haven't won in 27 years. Huh? And so you can't do nothing about it, but stop buying into it.
Mr. Dick Gregory. Please give him a warm, warm welcome.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me first say we thank and praise God that we've all made it here safely today. I pray to God that your return and my return will be equally as safe. Let me say thanks to Sister Cynthia for respect for you. We all showed up. Thank you. And thank you for the book. Thank you for what you had to say, all of you. Except it's kind of interesting when I hear people one after another talk about what have happened to civil liberties and all of that. I wonder what you would say if it was Indian sitting in here who ain't never had none and you ain't gave a damn about. If I broke into your house and killed your mother and father and your wife and children, blame me for it. But once my wife and children start living in that house with me, blame us all. And we black folks live in this house with this thug that stole from the Indians. So you get no special breaks when the final thing come down. And then so many people act like this was a good country at one time and God, but America ain't never been no good. That's an illusion. It is the most filthy, ungodly, unspiritual, heathen nation that's ever been put together in the history of the planet. And the reason they can do what they're doing to you, because you stupid enough to believe that somebody's going to cut somebody else some slack. Right. And these folks that's up top, not them redneck, nigger-hating crackers, the president of Harvard and Yale and MIT, they couldn't bug your phone without permission from AT&T. Not a little redneck, nigger-hating, Jew-hating thug on the corner. But they're easy for you to hate because they can't hurt you. But the ones that will hurt you. So now you worried about them bugging. They've been bugging my phone for so long. I'm glad they finally got around to you. But when all of us was trying to tell you what was happening, decent white folks out there, y'all didn't want to believe it, including black folks. That Jack Horn's Tonight Show, you accuse America of bugging your phone, what evidence you have. Every time a nigga can old Bell telephone $35,000 and they gonna cut the phone off, it's tapped. And so who I'm gonna call, the police? I've got little ghetto ways of getting even with them. I just call my wife every now and then and read the alphabets all backwards. And they'd be up 3 years trying to crack that code. Huh? Insane. I mean, now that they've taught us and trained us, like you said, can you recognize a terrorist? Even if they look like one. Just when I got to the point, I can recognize a terrorist. But I can't recognize drunken pilots that take the wrong one way and kill everybody on the plane except the pilot, like happened 2 weeks ago. So y'all running around, save me from terrorism so you can die from obesity. And how do you really deal with this insanity without talking about racism and sexism? Because as long as they're talking about niggas, you believe I'm going to get on a plane and blow myself up, but I get caught by the cops. What can they do to me to make me tell on my partners?
And it never dawned on you that's us doing that. I'm going to say this again. If I'm fixing to kill myself and you catch me, what kind of torture can you give me was worse than what I was fixing to do to myself? But y'all don't see through that. Sexism, they tell you in Europe, London, 2 weeks ago, that woman was going to get on the plane with her little two-month-old baby and blow it up. And you nasty enough and filthy enough to believe a mother would do that to her child. Right. I might blow up a plane, but I'm not taking the baby with me. Yeah, okay. But as long as they're talking about niggas, nobody questions it. And one day, when y'all deal with the real world, y'all know doing that sniper thing, especially you folks that live here. Every witness, including the FBI husband of the woman which his wife was killed, every witness said it was a white man in a white panel truck. Every witness, and they arrest two niggas in a car, and y'all go for it. That's what racism would do. Huh? That's what racism would do. Because if everybody's saying it was a white man in a white panel truck and it was two blacks in a car, then I need to go get the witness because they might be part of throwing me off. Huh? Poor little Cynthia, thank God for you. I hope you don't feel bad what happened to you down home. That's just a bunch of fools.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
That's right.
Because this thing have changed. The new is they arrest you. The old, they just shot you in the head, like Malcolm, like Martin, like Mega, like Mrs. LaRusso. Maynard Jackson. He had put a group together and raised enough black money to buy the Atlanta Hawks. And he got off a plane that Monday at 9:20 and fell dead. The problem is the Atlanta Constitution, Sunday night, on their website, and somebody kicked it off accidentally, ran the whole story about him being dead before he was dead. So y'all go on and live in this little old cute paper doll world. Yeah. I don't have no problem with them bebop. I don't give a damn what they say, whatever filth they use. I was born 1932 and there ain't been a dirty profanity word invented since I was born. So where'd they get it from? I called my mother a bitch when I was 9 years old because I heard my daddy call her a bitch. So why you gonna grab my ears? You didn't grab his ears, and 3 days later I hear y'all in the room making strange sounds. Get your hand off me. And all you black folks sitting around because somebody done turned you against your children. What can these niggas say filthy that was more filthy than that blues you wenches listen to about shake your money maker? Y'all dance to it. You call it blues. The only thing I'm saying money maker is you selling that pussy, you whore, and that didn't bother you. Huh? Are you crazy? Because you can never be a racist with your back, but you can have a white racist mentality. How long? Your problem, dear? You mess with white folk business. When I blew up the World Trade Building, that ain't nigga business. And that's what your problem was. Have nothing to do, but you got a blessing coming. Because see, they was going to put you in jail. See, the grand jury was going to indict you, and then they didn't have to explain how you lost the election. But Patrick Kennedy, I saw him last night. He waved at me, I said, thank you, brother. He smiled, you know what I'm talking about. Well, had it not been for him, you'd have been indicted by the same Capitol Police that took you before the grand jury, carried him home. But look how clever that white boy is now. He said, yeah, I took this medicine and the next day I was in bed. Now hear this now. I thought I was on my way to vote. And everybody laughed, but the United States Constitution says a senator or congressman going to or coming from a vote cannot be arrested by the police. That's what he was telling them. Okay? And even in my imaginary dream, I thought it was, I'm still covered. I think I saw him heading into a bar last night, but I don't know. They can't get you as long as old black woman told me a long time ago. There's a lot of water out there in that ocean, but it can't sink your ship till it gets inside. Don't let it get in there. Somewhere, when you stop and think what you was messing with, and what don't nobody want to talk about is Marvin Bush, the president's younger brother. He owned a company that was in charge of security for the World Trade Building. But the New York Times haven't told you. The little rednecks that you think that what your nigger hated, they didn't know. They'll kill them on the way to get you. And why that's so important, because the number two man in the FBI, John O'Neill, 5 years he knew about Operation Binko. I had all the data 4 years before September 11th. And he was trying to tell everybody in the FBI what was going to happen, the five targets. And they shifted him to New York and put so much pressure on him, he resigned. And then the security company, owned by Marvin Bush, called him. He said, John, I heard what happened, man. I'm really sorry, but we're looking for chief of security for the World Trade Building. Would you like the job? And he said, yes. And they tell us he died that morning. Huh? This is what this game is about. How long? And then they got nerve enough to tell us September the 11th panel suspected deception by the Pentagon. This was 3 weeks ago. They didn't say it when it happened. How long? And so I say thank you, my sister. Thank you. Thank you. Because many of us know what those nights are like when you're by yourself. When you know if you only behaved, you wouldn't hear him saying nasty things about you on the radio. You wouldn't hear black folks debating. See, I don't have them problems because I blame white folks for everything. If I woke up with a hemorrhoid this morning, I'd say white folk did it. Huh? I was cooking me some broccoli the other day and it burned. I looked around to see what white folk got in my apartment. Thank you, Dr. King. And the one beautiful thing about being in this room, I could reflect back to the civil rights movement and I see you. Huh? I see you. Huh? I see you, Mom. I see my man. I see all the people. Say, weren't we lucky? They didn't frame us. They tried. They didn't bust us on taxes. They tried. Ron Brown behaved himself, did everything good, and bullet in the back of his head. And how do I know that? Because the white folks that did the autopsy brought him to me. Huh? The games. And you black folks is equal as guilty because you should know more about the system than these white folks here.
That's right.
Huh? I mean, here's a country that put smallpox in Indian blankets to kill the women and the children, injected 600 black men with syphilis, and you question where AIDS come from? What kind of fool is you? Huh? What kind of God do you think you locked into? I remember when I first got the documents for some white folks, that Hoover had sent out the order to kill me. And just how much I love you, I wouldn't be here right now if it wasn't for you, because I was right in the middle early this morning. My wife, I think she's going to give me a divorce after 47 years. I didn't have no problem with it until white supremacy stepped in and a handful of white boys and a couple of white ladies and some hoes had an astrological convention and decided Pluto ain't a planet. Now, you can laugh if you want. That's law now. Pluto was here before white folks was here. They say you don't exist. And you worry about somebody bugging your phone? You know how far Pluto is from here? They messing around with Pluto. You don't exist, nigga. So I called my wife. Said I want a divorce. My children questioned me. Why you want a divorce? What am I do to you? Well, see, I married your mother because she had Pluto rising. But God keeps giving you your wake-up calls. Keeps giving you the crack in the fabric. Huh? You don't see it if you're angry. You don't see it if you're bitter. You don't see it if you're mean. That's what King was talking about. Love, love, love. Then you see the crack in the fabric. So when the white folk came and brought me the documents, I gave it to the Chicago Tribune. And it ran front page headline. FBI memo, use mob against Dick Gregory. Didn't bother me. Because if the God I pray to can't protect me against filth, I'd be the first one to say, I'm praying to the wrong God. I called a friend of mine this morning and said, just bought a $7 million house. Jeff, how you doing? He said, I woke up this morning. Hey, nigga, people going to electric chair woke up this morning. If you can't find a better reason for waking up than just waking up, then stay asleep. That's what got you in trouble. You woke up to change something. Hmm? And listen, this is what they say. They say, the late J. Edgar Hoover ordered the Chicago office of the FBI to develop counterintelligence measures to neutralize him. This should not be done in the nature of an expose, since he already gets far too much publicity. Instead, common, sophisticated, complete, untraceable means of neutralizing Dick Gregory should be developed. I'm still here. Who were dead? And this is the front copy. 8 agents, including the number 2 man, Sullivan. And I didn't know in 1965 that Mark Lane and I would do a book in 1976 that calls the Kennedy King assassination investigation. And because of that investigation, 6 of these 8 agents was brought in to testify. Not that they was accusing him of assassination, they had either investigated one or both of those assassinations. And all 6 of them died before they got there. Huh? So this is what this is about. Somewhere, when you understand the corruptness of this system and where it's going and how it's going. Here we are. United States Public Service. This is the government sending some folks 25 years of service. This certificate is awarded to, then they put the name in grateful recognition of 25. These were the black folks they injected with syphilis, but the first 25 years didn't nobody know it, so they sent them a certificate. That's how vicious this thing is, and nothing has changed. And the only reason you can live badly with this now is because folks like us in this room. Wouldn't it be nice if we could make this a humane society? But in America, when you hear the word humane society, you think of dogs. That's right. So do you need to have a convention to find out what this is about? How long? And so again, I just say to you, dear Keep walking tall. Don't worry about it. I don't wish death on nobody, but a whole lot of something after you'd be dead long before you. Don't worry about a thing. And don't hang around with people in pain, you know. Don't go and get all them other folks that they mess with, you know, like. If I catch my wife or somebody, I don't want to talk with somebody that caught their wife somebody because they say, kill the bitch. I want to talk to somebody who's been happily married for 60 years and say, don't worry about it. She didn't mean it, you know? And so I'll leave you. Oh, John, know what this is. This is the records of the 111th military intelligence that was sent in to kill King in case the Memphis police lieutenant, Earl Clark, missed. The 111th military intelligence, some mean, vicious, hoodlum thugs that would kill God if they had the chance. And King knew he was going to die. And King didn't die because of integration or segregation. King died because he was the first black person in the history of America that got in a position to determine public policy. Huh. And they got them all listed in here. Couple of brothers in there, too.
Okay. Tell the truth. That's right. Tell
the truth. It don't make any difference. And so I say to you today, this thing is bigger than we think it is. It used to be a handful of us. It's all of us now. Coca-Cola is on trial in northern Dallas because soda pop have a date of expiration, and when it gets past that date, the stuff turns into a mild poison. And some decent white folks and black folks blew the whistle on them after years of doing their dirt. And they're in federal court now because they found out when the whistleblowers blew that Coca-Cola go to the white stores and take all the expired Cokes out, take them to a warehouse in Northern Dow, redate them and send it to the black community. Now, ooh, nothing. Most of y'all so messed up in your head, you drink a bad Coke, you think something wrong with you. Well, there's something wrong with me. Every time I drink this Coke, I get the belching. Huh? No, see why I just say white folk did it. As bad as Coca-Cola is, you think pharmaceutical companies might be doing the same thing? Huh? You think they might go get all the medicine that lost all the juice in the white neighborhood and bring back to you and your pharmacy and your doctor who never suspect this says to you, your blood pressure has gone up. You're not taking the pills? Sure, I'm taking the pills. Well, you must not be. I am taking the pills. So they give you a higher dose. Huh? And y'all want to act like you live in? But thank God for those of you who's willing. You've almost pulled off a miracle. A democracy, you have to act like you're talking to little children. You know, you got all this old Harvard stuff and all this old kind of stuff. You know, Hollywood gave all y'all a wake-up call when out of the thousands of songs they had to pick to win, they picked "It's Hard Out Here Being a Pimp." No, but that's a wake-up. That's from the universe. That's, So I got on Al Sharpton's show the next day singing "It's Hard Out Here Being a Pedophile Priest." See if I'm a win. So we leave here, we lift this sister up. Every day at 12 noon. Lift her up, and you don't pray too long because y'all don't know how to pray. Just a quick fleeing few minutes. And everybody out here, there's a universal. These thugs have the money and the power to make bombs, to kill people. But if I cut my hand, there's nobody on this planet with their money or their power can make a scab. Huh? Huh? Harvard? Yale? None of them can make a scab. Only the universal creator can make a scab. And that scab is not made no different on me than Queen Elizabeth or welfare, ghetto sister or hillbilly white woman. And one great thing you got to always remember, baby, when they get to talking about right and wrong. If Hitler was sitting right here today and Jesus Christ sitting next to him, both of them get the same amount of oxygen.
All right.
There is no force that says that thug do not deserve the same amount of oxygen as Jesus. And so you got these idiots that want to torture people. That's how come I got out the army early. They told me something didn't even make sense. If you get captured by the enemy, give them number, name, rank, and seal them. I said, that's on my dog tags. They can get that much information if I'm dead. You got to give me something to negotiate with. Then them white folks won't tell me I'm a traitor. I'm an American. No, I'm not a traitor. This is my third day in the army, and I'm telling you now, call the Pentagon and put on my records, if Dick Gregory ever get caught, y'all change all your used to be secrets. Or is it something about a chump snatching my fingernails off and sticking pins in my eyeball and pouring hot water on my back? I tell her where my mama is. And if mama don't understand, she'll understand that hot water hit her back. And so let me leave you with this. This is a FBI document. Huh? FBI document. Here. You think they're doing something when they tap your phone? The relationship between lead exposure and homicide. FBI keeps records. Well, all you folks in the ghetto that kill one another, it had nothing to do with your blackness. It had something to do with lead poisoning. And then you stupid enough. My son called me. He hooked the crack. Brilliant, you know. Brilliant. He can touch your head and tell you what part of that star Cyrus you came from. He know that a crack do nothing but mess up your melanin. So he called me. I said, son, look, I never smoked a reefer. I don't know anything about crack. I love you, man. If you had a brain tumor, I don't qualify to cut your head. And please don't call your mama. She ain't never drank a beer. I said, but I know you're doing something wrong. Because nobody thinks it's negative about the FDA as I do. And that stuff you're taking is not even federally approved. And most of the stuff the FDA approved will kill you. So you stand on a corner taking some stuff from some criminals and swallow it, and now you want to call me? I don't understand it. And so Roger Masters said this. The only paper ran, it was Thursday, May the 29th, 1997, New York Daily News. Criminal crime is linked to pollution. Polluted water can cause brain damage that turn ordinary people into violent criminals. Researcher Roger Masters said at Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire, he compared crime figures from the FBI with information on industrial discharge of lead and manganese. He found a link between pollution levels and murder. Assault and robbery. Counties which have high pollution levels have a crime rate triple the U.S. average. So all of this stuff you can't see, but when they start telling you black on black crime, and that should bother white folks. When you ask black folks about what's black on black crime, well, we tired of black folk killing black folks. They didn't say they tired of black folk killing. They said they tired of them killing black folks. then who be left? And so the simple question is this. Who do you think killing Chinese in China tonight? And if we went to Italy tomorrow, who do you think killing Italians in Italy? And if 98% of all white folks that was murdered in America last year was murdered by white folks, if they're not talking about white on white crime, how do they trick you to talk about black on black crime? You kill where you live. And if you don't want black folk killing black folks, then join the NAACP, the Urban League, get with Jesse Jackson Group, and work to integrate this country. And I guarantee you, if I'm living over in this white suburban neighborhood and my old lady make me mad enough to want to shoot somebody, I'm not going to get in my car and drive back to the ghetto. So I say, sister, thank you. Thank you for making a difference. Thank you for waking, not just here, all over the world, people love you.
Right.
Indians on the Indian reservation, ask her, because she go up there all the time. My oldest daughter was in England, the London School of Economics, and I just happened to be over there because I don't like her too much. Cause... No, she too disciplined. I don't like black folks that want to be validated by a white racist system. Pay your bills on time. Never want to be late for an appointment. Why? What difference does that make? You think it make a difference? Ask Colin Powell. They say, nigga, go to UN Life Force. Okay, sir. See, they couldn't get you to do that. And then they found out they can't kill you. What a blessing. And so I just happened to been over there. And I picked up the London Times Monday, May 11, 1987. Smallpox vaccine trigger AIDS virus in Africa. Front page story. And a lot of people make a mistake trying to convince folks of something. Conspiracy theory. No, America's a conspiracy theorist. And so I leave you and I say to you, we can win this. I'm not going to tell you how, I'm going to tell you why. A democracy is a system where the least of us, the most educated, the least educated, the most wealthy, the least wealthy, the most female, the most male. We have a say-so in how we're going to be governed. That's a democracy. Now, you can look at Webster and they keep all that little confusion stuff about this, a democracy. No. A republic is a simple system. It's where a handful of elite aristocratic old men come together and decide what's good for all of us. And that's why I say you have done a hell of a job to make this system work right. Let me leave with this. Raise your hand right here. Repeat after me. I pledge allegiance
to the flag
of the United States of America
and
to the republic for which it stands. Fool. This has always been a republic. They teach you that in grade school is a republic. And we've almost made this republic work like a democracy. Because of the decent folks. The folks that's willing to die. We're saying, damn what you meant for it to be. This is what we're going to make it, and we're not going to trash your laws or nothing like that. And when your last bullet run out, sister, my advice to you is study the cockroaches and study the dinosaurs. Dinosaurs was bigger than mountains. Dinosaurs and cockroaches was here at the same time. Dinosaurs gone, cockroach still here. And if you want to see a dinosaur today, you got to go to a museum. You want to see a cockroach? Just put some stagnant water on the floor, they'll come to you. And you need somebody to test the water. Once the company know you're going to be testing the water, they would less be apt to put something in the water. Two, get a dog or a cat and put the water down. They don't drink it, and something's wrong with it. See, a dog or a cat,
And this is the father, the talking with Jimmy Jones, when they said Jimmy Jones and the people was drinking the Kool-Aid with the cyanide in it, and the cats and the dogs was dead. A dog would not drink straight Kool-Aid, less long Kool-Aid with cyanide in it, okay? If you take water out the tap and put it for a dog or a cat, they will walk around it, not just so happen. Chlorine and fluorine is a gas. All gas move to a higher level. And so there's a period when the dog or the cat will come and drink the water. But I would say don't drink the still water unless you're on a fast, because the still water will rob your body of minerals. Don't drink mineral water, because mineral water is radioactive. But spring water is the water to drink. That's number one. The body's 97% liquid, and out of that, it's 85% water. Alzheimer's disease comes from lack of drinking water. The lower back problems we have come from lack of drinking water. Gallstones and kidney stones come from lack of drinking water. And then again, if someone come and told you to drink clean water, even if what they said was wrong, if it didn't do nothing for you, it's not going to do nothing against you. You have not put anything in your body that would create any type of problem. Number two, physical fitness. And we as African Americans have to stop looking at physical fitness as some game. We have to stop looking at it as some age, as some sex. Every black person, regardless of how old they are or how young they are, babies get there. They move around in the crib, they, you know, do their thing. And so we got drinking water, physical fitness, and sleep. And if I had to rearrange that, I would probably put sleep first. Rest. One of the big horrors, particularly in the black community, it happens all over, is lack of rest. The body, the brain, 9 minutes after the sun go down, the radiation belt in the atmosphere do a flip-flop. And it recharges the brains, and all the sleep you get after midnight don't count. That's what the story of Cinderella's about. And so for those of you out there that's listening to me, try it. And usually, you say 7 days. Let me tell you how you drink your water. When you start drinking water, when you're not used to drinking water, you're going to go to the bathroom a lot if you have a job. And God didn't leave leeway for jobs. You know, Jesus Christ is God's son. Jesus didn't work. You know, if you look at all the rich, rich, super rich people, Prince Charles, they never had a job. And Queen Elizabeth, I don't think she even knew how to spell it. You know, and I believe if you went to Buckingham Palace and took every dictionary they had, I do not believe they put the word job in there or work. And so when you look and say, well, I can't do this because I have to work, that the universe will not bend over for you. Now, you get up in the morning, the minute you get up, you drink a glass of water. If you're not driving over long periods of time where you're going to need to go to the toilet, drink 2 glasses of water. When you get to wherever you're going, between that time and 11 o'clock, drink 2 more. Now you got the rest of the day to drink the other 4. Now, here's a simple law. Would a 6-month-old baby drink 8 glasses of water? No. Mothers give babies water by ounces, X amount of ounces. Well, the real game is we just say 8 8-ounce glasses of water. Whatever you weigh in pounds, you're supposed to drink half that in ounces. If you weigh 200 pounds, you're supposed to drink 500 ounces of water. If you weigh 1,000 pounds, you're supposed to drink 500 ounces of water. Now, let me tell you how water works. If I held up, if this was a piece of cloth, and I held it here, and I gave you a sharp hatchet, and you hit this cloth, you would tear it. If I put this cloth in a bathtub of water and you hit it, you couldn't tear it. Floats with the water. The body is the same way. If you fall, if you're injured, if you're in an automobile accident, this is why babies can fall out windows, we read about all the time, and don't die, because the water balance is there. Okay, and rest. Even when you're not sleeping, rest. And when I'm talking about rest, I'm not talking about on the phone talking. I'm talking about taking some time out every day where you just close the system down. Minute. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, just close it down. And that rejuvenates the body. And so now we're talking about sleep and rest, we're talking about water, and we're talking about physical fitness. Now, jogging is not physical fitness. Weightlifting is not physical fitness. Physical fitness is, first, your heel got to touch the ground. So if you're on a bicycle, that don't count. If you're walking up steps, that don't count. The heel got to touch the ground. If you're running, what is running? When both your feet is off the ground at the same time, it could be 1/10 billionth of a second, that's running. And what happens then? Because of gravity pull, anytime both your feet is off the ground at the same time, which is called running, when your legs, when your feet hit, it sends 2.5 times your body's weight up your legs to your knees, up to the spine, and sends shock waves to the brain, which damage it. And so walking. Now, walking in the evening don't count. In the morning, when you lay down in bed and go to sleep, the grease in your bloodstream comes up to the top. If you go out and walk vigorously, don't start off that way, but you have to walk to the point that you're just tired and sweating and all, you push all of that. Now, what you will notice if, well, even joggers, if joggers go out and run, the day they take off, they get very irritable around 10 o'clock. That's when that grease starts moving back into the bloodstream. And so the three things is rest. And you see, one of the great tricks, and it's funny, everybody working two jobs except the people that control. They don't work two jobs. Three jobs, four jobs, a job and something on the side. It's not about that. Show me somebody that has two jobs, I'll show you somebody that has no money at all. I mean, that's a game they play. I mean, some kind of way we have to redo our priorities. And we have to say, wait to the system. It's, you know, it's about my health. It's about my love. It's about my kindness. It's about my gentleness. And those three things, you'll see a difference in 7 days. Now, how do you get into the physical fitness? Well, I can't do it. I got a bad leg. Didn't walk bad. I told you there was $20 million worth of gold over there. And every morning, if you walk 2 miles, you could get it. Bad leg, folks, everybody be out there walking. So what you have to do is start slow. Start 5 minutes. And then after a week or 3 days, the problem you have, someone hear this and say, he's right, I got to do it. Then they go out and hog it, and something breaks, and don't, you know. When you get through, then do your physical fitness. Do your physical fitness. I say to people who haven't trained, you out there that's 80 years old, 60, 40, been out of high school 20 years, haven't been physical, stand in the mirror when you do your physical fitness naked. And why did I say naked? See, if you had clothes on, you're doing physical fitness, you hear something go zoop, you say, oh, I tore my shirt. If you're naked and hear something go zoop, you know that's you. And the minute you feel something, that's God saying, stop. Stop. It'll heal. The minute you feel it, stop. Don't push it. And once that heals, go back. And that's all I can say. Water, physical fitness, and rest. And if you said four, it'd be the diet. Very important. And when we talk about water, Kool-Aid don't count, lemonade don't count, orange juice don't count, fresh grapefruit juice don't count. Why? Because they have to go through the digestive system. Water goes directly into the system and starts purifying the system, and also it cools the body. It's your cooling system. One of the problems we have, you know, can you imagine every year, every cell in your body, your brain has a convention, check you out. Say, well, what's old Brother Greg doing this year? Say, well, you know, he's 15 years old and he's drinking too much Kool-Aid and he's not drinking enough water. Say, okay, let's give him a warning. Let's put thirst. Where are we going to put it? Well, he got to be kind of stupid, so let's put it right in his throat. And we ignore it. And we ignore it. And then when you get about 60 years old, some people, 49, 50, they come every year and have this meeting. They say, well, what do you think? Say, well, let's take his right to get thirsty away. There's no need in wasting the time. That's with Alzheimer's disease. And if you don't believe it, find people with Alzheimer's disease and ask them, when's the last time you've been thirsty? They can't tell you. You lose that right. If I'm limping and limping and limping, I ran from Los Angeles, California to New York City. I averaged 50 miles every day for 71 days. And I thought I had trained for it, except what I didn't know is you don't run on the highway, you run on the side of the highway. So there's gravel over there. So now I have to be very careful running on gravel, and I developed a whole new set of muscles up here I had never used before.
In no particular order, since we mentioned Dreamer first, tell me about Dreamer. When I saw the State of the Black Union, Dick Gregory really moved me and a lot of my friends. I show it to everybody that comes over the house, especially white folks, because they need to hear that, you know, so that they know more about all of us. Mm-hmm. Because what he said affects all of us. He said something that really hit home about this phenomena of chemtrails. And, you know, when I was a kid, I used to see these trails in the sky all the time. And say, oh, that's cool. A jet just went over. And then you started to see a whole bunch of them. And next thing you know, everybody in your neighborhood was fighting and arguing, and you didn't know why. Okay? And you really didn't know why. I mean, everybody was fighting. So he started riffing about the chemtrails. And he started to say things that hit home so hard. And I would recommend that everybody try to get what he said online or wherever and try to get a copy of it and just listen to it. Mm-hmm. Because I was so moved that I had to write the song.
And then when you leave, with all the hassle, can you have that love?
Love.
I'm so tired of you black folk walking around looking all evil like that's gonna change something. Looking all mean and talking all crazy. Let them tell you about your children. If I sit here today and these are all white folks and they're putting some sleeping pill in my water and I sit up here and doze off and go to sleep and everybody told in the world, niggas is lazy. They tired. No, that's because you too naive enough to know what they putting in my water. Okay? Your children ain't violent because they black. They ain't violent. Most people in the world live in a ghetto. They don't kill people. What are you putting in my malt liquor, white boy? What are you putting in? Huh? Hear me. And it's your fault too. Malt liquor is made by white companies, but only sold in black neighborhoods, and you ain't checked it to see what's in it. Huh? Lead are you putting in my neighborhood? Lead affects my thinking capacity. Lead is only one thing on the planet more dangerous than lead, and that's manganese. Manganese will make you kill your mama. And let me tell y'all something. If you want to see the largest homicide rate in the world, it ain't in no black ghetto in America. It's a little town in Australia where them white folks' homicide rate is 200 times what their population is. And that town just happened to be located across the street from a manganese plant.
Sit back down, Dick. Don't lose that mic. Yeah.
That town is located across the street from a manganese plant. How much manganese are you spraying in my neighborhood at night while I'm asleep? How in the world can a 9-year-old child find a heroin man, but the FBI can't find it, and you gonna tell me that's a black thing? Y'all crazy? What is this about? These are the things that need to change while this brother and sister's on their way to the White House. And when you see Hillary and y'all see Brother Barack, thank him for me. And you white folks need to be thankful. Because if y'all had a brother like me, y'all would really be in trouble. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Okay?
Ladies and gentlemen, Dick Gregory.
I was so moved that I had to write the song. The other thing is the first line of the song says I was born on the same plantation in the United States of the red, white, and blue. And we live in a place now that feels just about like a plantation. We're all indentured servants, you know. When I found out there were 8 presidents before George Washington, I wanted to smack somebody. Mm-hmm. You know, I wanted to know why I was taught otherwise. Just tell me the whole story. I'll fill in the blanks. But don't tell me something that you think I'm supposed to know.
We're indentured servants and we got a black president now?
Well, I don't vote. I have nothing to do with it. I got no dog in that race.
And for those who would cuss me out and slap me in person if I didn't ask you why?
Well, the reason why is because I'm one of Jehovah's Witnesses, and we've never voted. And that's not to say that I don't think Barack Obama, President Obama, is a very smart individual, and he seems like he means well. Prophecy is what we all have to go by.
But first, let me forget the intellectual stuff right now, which I love, and I've got to get down to some personal business, which you'll probably find out about after we leave here. I was standing back in the back waiting to come on when you had your sponsors out here. So when they came by, they passed me, and I did say something to them. And I know they're going to tell you. See, I thank the white dude from Walmart for my cousin. This past Christmas, they had prices so low, he didn't have to shoplift.
Yeah.
The brother that passed by from ExxonMobil, now a lot of people don't know, they had gift packages for us, you know? And they had an ExxonMobil credit card for gas.
Right.
I gave him mine back. Because I said every time I go to Exxon and buy gas, I love water. A gallon of water costs more than a gallon of gas. Can you give me a water card? Yeah. Be honest, the black brother from Wells Fargo, head of the mortgages, I pulled him over and said, I need to talk to you. He said, Brother Greg, you need a mortgage. I said, no, they took my house when times was good. Here's what I asked him.
Yes, sir.
I asked for a loan and a cosigner to open up a black business. I want to open up a black airline named Tamika Air. And my motto will be, we leave late, but we get you there on time. Major white airlines will be the only one can say we guarantee we won't lose your luggage because you can't bring none with you. And we're going to be a good Christian airline. We ain't selling no alcohol on the plane. You bring your own, we just sell the setup. So I just want to. That's all. Now to my mayor, Mr. Mayor. I just want you to know how bad things are. When you said Chocolate City, I had just walked in the hotel room. I was in Europe and turned on the news, and I heard you say Chocolate City. I thought you was talking about Hershey, Pennsylvania. And then I heard all the white folk complaining about you call this town Hershey, Pennsylvania. Look, all my life, they
call this town Sin City, and nobody cares. Deceitful, nasty, ungodly, unspirit. When you said chocolate means love, kindness, tastes good, is good. So do color matter? Let me tell you something. I had a dream last night. Now I'm 75 years old. I dreamed I saw God. Now, being 75, I said, excuse me, Mr. God. Can I have a word with you? He said, yes, my son. I said, you know, they just had a Polish pope. Will we ever get a black pope? He said, yes, my son, but not while I'm God. Son. And finally, let me say this. Thank you. Thank this movement. I'm not talking about the ones we know about. I'm talking about the ones we don't know about. Thank God there is a God that know all the names. And because of this movement, I didn't come up in a civil rights family. Nobody teach me that. I thought everything was okay. I didn't get it at home. And when I heard it at home, I heard it from some ignorant part of view. It's these redneck, uneducated, pot-belly crackers that create the problem. And at 9 years old, I say, since when that type of white boy determined public policy? My problems with the president are horrible. And Yale and MIT and the major corporations, until we leave this little daddy boy alone, we will never deal with it. And so again I say, where I am from this movement, it gave me a turtle philosophy after looking at that black woman I'm married to and being part of this movement. I am the turtle. On the outside, soft on the inside, and willing to stick your neck out. That's what it's about. That's what it's about. That's what it's about. And all of us in this movement, I come up as a black man thinking hard on the inside, hard on the outside, but I wasn't hard on nobody but black folks. And looking at my wife deal with 10 black children with softness, that I became soft, the inside. And finally, let me just say this. I'm tired of people talking about this election from the standpoint of fear. Fear and God do not occupy the same space. Listen. I don't want nobody to tell me and tell my grandchildren to go to the polls and vote against something. That's ungodly. With the beauty of this country and all the things we got to vote for, you don't have to tell me about Bush. When I see him on TV, I say to my grandchildren, if he was alive, he'd be a sick man. So busy teaching me about the devil, I'm a grown man before I found out the beauty of God. I don't need to talk about the filth. The filth speaks for itself. For itself. And I say thanks to the two most powerful folks in the history of America, the black woman and the black church. I never knew how smart that black woman was
till I look at my wife Lillian. That didn't make it. It was when Kobe Bryant got in that mess. You remember? They accused Kobe Bryant of raping a white woman, and he went home and bought his wife a $4 million diamond ring. Let me tell you something. If a white woman accused me of raping her, and I go and give my wife a $4 million diamond ring, she'll go get two more white women. To know wherever that ring came from, there's a matching necklace and bracelet. Oh.
Dick Gregory.
Now, let me say this. All we said here, what needs to be said, we think an illegitimate child is a child that don't know where their daddy is. America is an illegitimate child because she has no mother. And this is what the problem is. If I work in a coal mine, in a steel mill, and I come here today and put on a suit but don't take a bath, you got stink sitting up here with you. And what have happened to America, we ain't never cleaned up the filth over 400 years. We just put a new suit on and a new dress on and then wonder who's stinking. It's you the one that's stinking. That's what this is. And until we clean this out, until we clean it up, my mama used to grab me and wash my face. America ain't got no mama that's washing her face. She'd pick my nose when it needed to be opened up. She'd look in my ears. All we do is we went from this filth we was in to putting on some new clothes, and nobody has said, hey, somewhere we got to apologize. First to black women. White women's okay, but that black woman went through racist white system and sexist black me. And we ain't never said what you've been through. And in spite of that, look at that black woman. Look at Kathy Hughes. She didn't have the privilege of a ladies' movement when she's putting that empire together. Look at Dorothy Hike, huh? Look at all these women that have come through, the late Dolores Tucker. Look at what's going on now with E. Faye Williams talking about Sojourner Truth, and we will have that statue in the White House. Our women, if you think this sister just a politician, what she had to go through to get there, cause she was a woman. And we have never slowed up and said, thank you, ladies. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And until we do that, until we are able to do that, I look at Dr. Condoleezza Rice, hear me. And we tolerated. She has more PhDs than the president's whole cabinet. Huh? Hear me. And you hear me too, black folks. They call her Condi, but they never call Madeleine Albright's Maddie, never call Janet Reno Janie. Henry Kissinger, Dr. Henry Kissinger. And let me tell you, she don't see nothing wrong with it. Let me tell you something. They got a soda pop in America. Blacker than her, they call Dr. Pepper. Huh? Huh? Dr. Pepper. Huh? Ladies. Huh? And if you go to the store today when you leave here, and don't ask for it by its full title. Say, give me a pepper, they'll give you a chili pepper. I wish Bill Clinton was here, so I would apologize to him for you black folks. See, you black folks tricked him. You went in that big old black pot and said, here, white boy, you black. Huh? And then you went back in that black pot and said, here, Obama, you ain't black enough. What kind of fool is you? Huh? What kind of fool is you? Huh? You, the Ku Klux Klan, did not say Obama too white. You did.
And so Bill was here. I said, Bill, I'm gonna apologize to you. Because black folks not only told you, but tricked you. See, I have a son, a chiropractor now, Christian. He's 8 years old. He came to me crying. He said, Daddy, my brothers and sisters is laughing at me. I said, why? He said, well, I built me one of these castles, and I make like it's my house. And do you see anything wrong with that? I said, well, how old are you, boy? He said, 8 years old. I said, no, ain't nothing wrong with that until you try start using it as your address. So I tell Bill Clinton, ain't nothing wrong with being black long as you're playing. But when you try to use it as your address, then I got some serious questions. Have you and your wife and your daughter ever been standing on a street corner in New York and a cab passed you by because you're the black president? Huh? Huh? Have you ever had Chelsea pulled over by the white police because our daddy's the black president? Mr. President, do you know what it feels like to be a black person? To be a Congress lady? Huh? To be a lieutenant governor with 12 doctor's degrees and driving down the street and hear the police siren and you start squeezing that steering wheel tight and they pass by you and you thank God, damn thanking God, you didn't do nothing in the first place, huh? Do you know what you did? Then you can be black, huh? Then you black, huh? Then you black. Until then.
Tell it,
huh?
Tell it, Brother Gregory.
That's what this is about.
That's what we're talking about.
That's what this is about, huh?
Well, I'm excited for this new year, but more importantly, I'm excited about my next guest. He's my friend. He's somebody who educates us, entertains us. He makes us laugh and think all in the same sentence. He's our friend, our professor, Dick Gregory. Welcome back to the show, brother. Blessings to you.
Good morning, my brother, and hope you had a nice holiday and getting ready to have a happy new year.
Yes,
to
sir.
To you,
yes,
and the listeners and the public. But before we go into the new year, we're going to be in for a special rare occasion that's not controlled by the CIA or terrorists or the White House or the FBI. This is universal. What happens tomorrow is we are going to be treated to a blue moon. Now, what is a blue moon? A blue moon is any time the full moon occurs twice in 1 month. And that's, so what happened is on December the 2nd was the full moon.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the interesting thing of that, I was down in Harper's Ferry celebrating the 150th anniversary of the hanging of John Brown.
Mm-hmm.
And that was on the 2nd, the full moon. December the 2nd was the first full moon for December, and now December the 31st will be the second full moon, which is very, very rare. It'll be visible New Year's Eve in the United States, Canada, Europe, South America, and all of Africa. Now, it's kind of interesting because a full moon occurs every 29.5 days. And most years have 12 full moons. On an average, an extra full moon happens, a blue moon, what is called, two, occurs every 2.5 years. The last time we had that lunar double take was in May the 2007. New Year's Eve, it occurs rarely, every 19 years. The last time, that was in 1990, and the next one won't be until 2028. So we in for a special treat from the universal gods. And if we was back, you know, 6,000 years ago, the pagans would be going crazy now. Because, you see, on December the 20th, see, the pagans were celebrating Christmas and Easter 3,000 years before Christ was born. And so the celebration we have nothing to do with theirs, except we take part of, for instance, on December the 21st, again, this is not controlled by the Vatican, this is controlled by the universe, that is the winter solstice, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, you take all your armies and all your banks, you can't change that. We just came out of fall, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was September the 21st. Now, if you lived on the 70th floor of your apartment, see, I know about your other apartment you got. now, when it go up, the water gets up to the 70th floor by pressure, right?
Right.
So if I go down to the basement of your apartment and shut the pressure off, right, then the water pressure is no longer there.
Right.
So the water that's in the pipes starts falling down, right?
Right.
That's what happens in September. The universal God shuts off the faucet. That's why it's called fall. That's why the leaves on the trees and everything turns brown.
Man, that's deep, boy. Golly, that's deep.
Now we going into the winter period. Then in the spring, the God turns the faucet back on. That's why it's called spring. It springs up. So as we talk about the CIA and the whole terrorist thing, understand, y'all out there, this is chump stuff, okay? The CIA, with all their corruptness, and America deserves what you get. Anytime you can have somebody as filthy as the CIA and the FBI manipulating stuff, see, fear and God do not occupy the same space.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now when we're talking about the spring of the year, We talk about Easter, right?
Mm-hmm.
Easter is a Latin word called Esther. Okay, Esther means fertility. That's why Easter is represented by a rabbit and an egg.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, Easter can never come. Easter is always the first Monday after the first full moon, after the first new moon, after the spring equinox. That determines Easter. The first. Do you know all over the world, Easter never falls? Look, if Christ is crucified on Friday, first, I don't like the idea that they can manipulate me and tell me they killed my Christ on Friday and convince me to call it a good day. Okay?
Right, right.
All right. Now, okay. Understand? And so consequently, if I bought $10,000 from you this Friday, and I know where you keep your little stash, too. If I bought $10,000 from you, I want you to hold your fingers out. That's how we learn how to count, remember?
Uh-huh.
If I bought $10,000 from you on Friday and say I pay you back in 3 days, count on your finger, what day do you get your money back?
I get it back on Monday.
Okay, now you see, it's so simple. If Christ is killed on Friday, I have no doubt about that.
Uh-huh.
But don't give me 2 days and don't come up with no crap about the calendar this, right? 3 days is 3 days. All over the world where Christians are, Easter is celebrated Easter Monday. It's a holiday, except in America. The only city that celebrates is in the Washington, D.C. area. It's because they into the occult. It's Easter Monday. Schools are closed in this area. I say this area because it takes in certain parts of Virginia and certain parts of Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
Are closed down. That's when they have the Easter egg hunt on the White House lawn on Monday. Many years ago, with racism rigid, Negroes was not permitted to bring their children to the White House, so black folks went to the zoo. This is the only city in the world where Easter Sunday and Monday, Negroes dress up and go to the zoo. You know? And so consequently, now, let's go back to the pagans now. The pagan, and y'all shouldn't be scared of that word. You know, 10,000 years from now, they'll say Catholicism. Huh? Catholicism was the same, not the same, but paganism was the same thing they called theyself as the Catholics called theyself, okay? And so consequently, what we're looking at is on December the 20th. You see, Christmas can never come till 270 days after Good Friday. That's why it's called a good day. For instance, I'm born October the 12th, 1932. You count 270 days from October the 12th, and you find out 270 days back, That's when my mother conceived, okay? You need no DNA test and all that to find out when it happened, right? Mm-hmm. Now, 270 days. Now, we know that Martin Luther King was killed on April the 4th, okay? And every year we have celebrations. Kennedy was shot in Dallas on November 22nd, okay? Mm-hmm. Every year there's festivities of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if Jesus Christ is killed on Friday, I have no doubt about it. How come one day, you know, Good Friday comes in April, another year come in March? You can't be killed in 2 different months.
That's true.
And so, if you count 270 days from Good Friday, right, they know that Christmas cannot come before December the 25th, but it can come as late as January the 6th. Every now and then, it can come before the 25th, and every now and then, it can come after January 6th, but very rarely. So now, when the pagans, on December the 21st, on the paganism now, the sun dies for 3 days. It's called death of the sun. Let me show you something. If you look up in the sun, you ever use a little boy and look up in the sun and see that black ball before you close your eyes?
Mm-hmm.
All right? If you light a candle in your house today, if you get off the show, and I know where your candles are, if you light a candle and look into the center, that by the wick, right?
Uh-huh.
You see blue. Okay?
Right.
The further you get away from the blue, it gets red or yellow, because that represents death. So when you look and see that red stuff up there by the sun, you're not seeing the sun, you're seeing the death. Why do you think they call it, if your account is messed up, you in the red, right?
Mm.
That comes from the death of the sun. And if your account is in good shape, you in the what? The black, right?
Because
mm-hmm. the sun is black. Okay? And so now what the pagans did, you're kind of young, so I don't know if black folks were still putting wreaths on the door when there was a death.
No, I've never heard or seen that before.
The people listening, they know. You put a wreath on the door. So if me and you was going to your grandmother's house today,
mm-hmm.
and we see this wreath on the door, we know there's a death in the family. But the wreath, the arm, the band is either purple or it's black. Why? Because when you die, you go back to another life, which is black. Okay? The sun's death represents red. That's why the Christmas wreath has a red ribbon on it. Okay?
Mm.
Now, what the pagans would do is they would put the wreath up on December the 21st. That's the death of the sun, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, midnight. So if you count 3 days from midnight, the first day, December the 22nd, midnight, December the 23rd, midnight, December the 24th, midnight, right?
Mm-hmm.
1/10 billion of a second past midnight the 24th, the morning of the 25th, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what the pagans were saying on December the 25th, the sun is born. Okay, so they get you hung up in all kind of rituals, and that's why the Bilderbergers and all them thugs out there that control, do you know the people that run the world ain't never had a job? And so when you think about, they can pull you off your circuit and put other stuff into you. The church don't heal me, but gives me the type of outlet in this brain. And finally, before we get into the other, you see, the universe put me here. Okay, I'm of the universe. Queen Elizabeth is the richest white woman. The three white woman, the richest woman on the planet, a Chinese woman, right? The richest white woman is Queen Elizabeth. She makes $360 million every 24 hours, just interest on her money. Okay.
Wow.
Now, if Queen Elizabeth came to St. Louis today and sit next to my welfare cousin, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Both of them breathe in the same amount of air. You see, the universal God don't have no kings or queens or popes or bishops, okay? The universal God is everything is equal. And so if you held Queen Elizabeth's nose and mouth, huh? For 30 minutes, she would die. That money ain't going to help her. If you held my welfare cousin's nose and mouth for 30 minutes, she going to die, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so when you look at universal order, the universe is right in front of you right now. The same universe that's all over the universe, Warren, is in front of you. Every everything in the universe comes, it's with you 24 hours a day. You don't have to go looking for it. But we go to different places to look for it. And so consequently, as we go into, as this thing opens up now on what happens Sunday, okay, we got to sit back and say, wait a minute, don't get scared. Fear and God do not occupy the same space. Mm-hmm. And so consequently, if the pagans was here now, their Christmas would be the 5th of January. That's 270 days. So those who really understand that, they're getting ready to have fantastic celebration. So now what happens now is the CIA, the FBI, every major, if you take all the armies on the planet and put them together under one commander, they can't take my welfare cousin that's 9 months pregnant and turn them weapons on her and dare that baby to come out. When 9 months pregnant is over, that's called evolution. It's a gradual nature which is change leading into revolution, which is quick change. And when that happens, the universe gonna drop that baby if it means death to the mother and the child. We have to listen and not be frightened, because once you can let the CIA and the FBI and British intelligence scare you, then you're in trouble. Now, let's go back to Dick Nixon. When he was president, he appointed John Mitchell as his attorney general, okay?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, when you become the attorney general of the United States, you become the most powerful cop in the history of the planet, because America is the most powerful nation in the history of the planet.
Right.
So when John Mitchell, who had a New York apartment, and him and his wife was there on the weekend, he had the old white boy crowd by, and they smoking their cigars and drinking their cognac, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
She overheard them, because she wasn't in the room, this was a man thing, right? She overheard them discussing blowing up the World Trade Building, okay?
Well, when Dick Gregory was in, when Dick Nixon was in office?
Did you hear me? Now, watch this. After they left, she went in, got on and said, I cannot believe that you sitting here with these hoodlums, powerful white men, planning this. How can you be part of that? He said, I have nothing to do with it. He said, well, I'm going and hold a press conference and tell the world. Did you remember when she got kidnapped?
Mm-hmm.
Now, think about this. When you kidnap the Attorney General's wife of the United States, the most powerful cop in the world, and to this day, as you and I talk now, nobody's been arrested. Now, we don't have to go no further than there, right? Mm-hmm. Did you hear what I just said?
I heard you.
When you kidnap the Attorney General's wife of the United States, and to this day, there's been no arrest made. They shot her in her butt with a cancer shot, and not too long after that, she was dead. Okay? Now, that's put a period there. When that thug couple slipped in the White House on Thanksgiving Eve, right?
Right.
Those are gangster cops, man. You know what they was telling Obama?
We can get to you.
We get to you anytime. Look, you can almost slip in heaven easier than you can in the White House. Okay, we can get to you. Now, wait a minute. They didn't get caught, man. And they said, well, they went through the scanner. They didn't have no explosives. Hey, man, do you know how many people in the CIA and in the military know how to kill you with one karate chop?
Right.
Okay, now, let me tell you what that day was. That was the day for Thanksgiving, right?
Right.
The special state dinner was for the Prime Minister of what? India, right?
Right.
So Thanksgiving Day, all the news around the world was about this couple that slipped in the White House, right?
Right.
Now go back a year ago Thanksgiving. What was the news about? India. The hotel that got blown up.
That's right.
Now, what
that's
the
right.
Odds of Thanksgiving. It's involving something about India. So they just said to the Indian Prime Minister, we could have got you that night, punk. And to the President, you, your whole family, okay? And so now, all at once now, we find out that this couple, you know, they didn't catch them. They put on their blog that night. You aware of that?
Yeah, what? Yeah, they put it all on Facebook, on their blogs, okay, everything. They got away with it.
No intelligent folks caught them.
Right.
Well, let's stop talking about intelligence. You know how stupid You got to be to go to college with aspirations to being a star. That's not going to college, going to be Mickey Mouse when you grow up. My grandmother, who couldn't read or write, had more intelligence than these stuff. She was just more godly and spiritual and didn't use her as they thuggery. Now, let's watch this now. Now, we find out that Harry Reid, right?
Mm-hmm.
He texts White House. Now, you know Harry Reid have a different number to text the president.
Right.
Than the rest of the folks, right?
Right.
He texts them 3 days before the state dinner to say he, his wife, and his family would not be there because they going to Utah for Thanksgiving, right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't you know that that couple had gotten in touch with the people at the Pentagon, okay, and said, "Oh, you know the invitation you're trying to get for us. Well, Harry Reid and his family's not going. See if that's okay." Now, how can they get, you hear me, a secret text out of the White House 3 days before the dinner? Okay? Now, this is what Obama is dealing with. Now, let's go to Ronald Reagan. When Reagan thought he was in charge, right?
Mm-hmm.
They asked him to do something with Henry Kissinger, and he hated Kissinger. And they tricked him with a couple of things, and one of the ones involved with the trick was Congressman McDonald out of California, in Atlanta. Remember Congressman McDonald?
I remember.
He's the one on 007 when the plane went down. McDonald
was
killed on that flight. Okay, and so after Reagan decided he would do what the boys want, but before then, he's an actor. He said, "Well, I'm the president. I'm running." So that night, when he got ready to go to bed, he went up and two men were sitting on his bed.
Hold on. I gotta let you finish this Reagan with the man at the bed. We up against commercial break. For everybody who's listening, just tuning in, we're talking to the Professor Dick Gregory, and we're talking to you, Truth Fighters, right here, right now. It's the Warren Ballantyne Show. All right, Truth Fighters, if you're just joining us, just tuning in, we are talking with the Professor Dick Gregory. When we went to break, Dick was talking about how Ronald Reagan woke up with a man.
No, not woke up. He went. In the White House, went up to his room where he sleeps to get ready to go to bed. It was two men, the same ones that he talked to and told him he was president. They were sitting on his couch, on his bed.
Okay. Now, what was the conversation? What were they waiting for him for?
Kissinger. That's why Kissinger, now you can punch it up. Kissinger cannot leave this country. He's been indicted for murder at the Hague Court. And that's why Kissinger's files was secretly wrapped up as if though he was the president. Okay, all of those death squads, Kissinger put them together under Ronald Reagan's watch when Reagan didn't want it. Okay, now let me show you how it works. You talk to your mother every day, right?
Every other day.
Okay, well,
You know, I can only take so much of peaches now. Peaches,
okay,
you know me a little bit.
Okay, all right. Now, so let's look at it now. Well, don't talk to peaches every day. One day, talk to the fuzz. All peaches got fuzz.
You a mess.
Now, watch this. Let's say you and your mother have this huge mansion, right?
Mm-hmm.
That you share. One, she shares another one your brother shares, huge mansion, right?
Right.
Now, let's say the mansion is 80 years old, right?
Right.
So let's say you bought it for the family 20 years ago, right?
Right.
So then the house then was 60 years old, right?
Right.
Did y'all search that house for secret doors and secret rooms and stuff?
Probably not.
Okay, now. So what make you think that the President of the United States is going to check the White House for little secret doors? Now, let's go to Dracula. Remember the movie?
Yeah, Dracula.
You remember the white lady was laying in the bed, sleep with that wonderful gown on, and they showed the full moon? Remember?
Right.
And then they showed the wolf. Ooh, ooh. And then when they showed back in the room, what you thought was bookstands, them doors had slid open, the old wolf man there.
Right.
And now she laying in bed dead, and the doors closed, right?
Right.
All right. Now, I'm saying this to say what they did the other day. You see, when they threw the shoe at Bush, okay,
mm-hmm.
They was telling him, "You don't control this. It could have been germ warfare, punk, and you'd have been dead." Hmm?
Right.
See, we look at it as a hue. We don't look at the significance of how it's impossible for somebody to do that with all the people scattered around in the audience that just look like ordinary people.
Right.
Did you see what they told the Pope the other day?
Oh, yeah, when the lady jumped over to the aisle?
Wait a minute. Listen, they told the Pope, you ain't in charge, right? Do you know the Pope has Swiss guards? You aware of that?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know the Pope's guards cannot be Catholic? Did you know that?
Yeah, I knew that.
Now, think about how is this mighty church telling everybody to be Catholic, but the people who guard the Pope can't be Catholic? Is that kind of, huh?
Yeah, that's kind of backwards.
Okay, now, so they just told the Pope the other day, whatever it is we've been asking you, you know, I've been listening to, she could have took you out. Okay? Now, let's go back to Queen Elizabeth. Now, this is really, because they kind of hinted. See, all you got to do is hint scandal, and people forget to dig for facts, right?
Mm-hmm.
You remember Queen Elizabeth woke up one night, and there was a man in the room?
I do remember that,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and now, if you think you can slip in the palace with the palace guard, right? So she kept talking to him and pushing the buzzard, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the buzzard. And it came for 20 minutes. Since when do my palace guard, where was it? Down the street at McDonald's? She said, well, can I help you? Do you want? They were letting her know you are not in charge, okay?
Right.
Now, the message the other day was, they wasn't blowing up the plane, man. The message the other day is, whenever we get ready to do it, we can do it, okay? Now let's watch this. Now, let's go back to the plane, okay?
Right.
You heard the news on Christmas Day. It always happens on a holiday when everybody's at home, right?
Right.
And they can feed you the same stuff. But here's the problem with 24-hour news now, huh? The CIA, see, they can control NBC, CBS. Do you realize 98% of the lesbian and gay bars and joints in Washington, D.C. is controlled and operated by the CIA and the FBI? Do you realize why it's going to be hard to get this investigation going? Because they got so much dirt on the senators and Congress. But you remember Nancy Pelosi said the CIA lied to us?
Right.
And them Republican thugs and the Democrats who's on the payroll because they can... See, you don't have to do nothing. When you got the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Chicago Tribune, when you got them in the hip pocket, right?
Right.
And all they got to do is flash stuff. And they pick it up. So why wouldn't my grandmother believe it, right?
Right.
And so consequently, what they're able to do now is they say, now, here's a guy that came over here on a plane. But what they wasn't ready for. Now, let's go back, because you've been watching this on TV, right?
I've been following.
All right, now, let's go back. He's sitting on a plane. They made a mistake to show the diagram of the plane. You know, when you look at these boats that they brought the slaves on, how they show you a top view of how they was there?
Right.
So they did a diagram of the plane, and they showed you a red dot was sitting, right?
Right.
Then they told you the hero. Did you see the hero with his hand all bandaged up?
Yep.
Like he got burned.
Right.
Right. But the people sitting next to him, nobody got burned, right? Now, if you look at the dot and then see how far back on the plane he was, right?
Right.
How do he know what's going on up there? Oh, listen, he knew, right?
Right.
So he runs up. How do you know the guy wasn't drunk? I mean, when you look at him, he looked like a 13-year-old innocent little child. Okay, he runs up, right? Now, nobody around him grabbed him, right?
Right.
He runs up from the back and grabbed him, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's where they messed up. You saw him, the government, FBI and them, putting handcuffs on him, right?
Right.
On him, right?
Right.
He had a white T-shirt on, right?
Right.
Who took them pictures, man? If you and I are in the bank today, right?
Right.
If somebody robbed a bank and you pull your camera out to take a picture, don't every cop in there think it's a gun?
Yep.
Okay, so what makes you think in the middle of one of the major operations since September the 11th, right?
Right.
That they're going to let some ordinary citizen with his damn camera take a picture of this operation? First, you don't know how many people on that plane is with him.
Right.
So you can't have nobody gathering around. You got to have them seated down. You hear me? So
right.
Nobody's questioning who took that picture, right?
Right.
Now where they messed up with that 24-hour news, they interviewed a husband and wife. Did you see that? They said before anybody boarded the plane, my husband and I were standing, you know, waiting for him to board, and we saw this young man was a well-dressed Indian. Huh?
Yeah, and look, the husband and wife, I think the husband was an attorney.
Yep. Right. With this well-dressed Indian, right?
Right.
And we heard him say to the gate agent, he have to get on this plane, and he don't have no passport, right?
Right, right.
And so the guy said, well, look, we can't let him on. He said, well, what about your supervisor? He said, well, let me go get him. The supervisor came and carried him on, right? They were asked on TV, well, did the FBI interview you? Say, yeah. For how long? Oh, about 15 minutes. Have anybody gotten in contact with you since? No. Now, think about this, man. His husband and wife told him what we see. Now, first, you got to talk to them, because if they lying, they could be part of it. The father of the young man went to the American Embassy.
Right.
And that's controlled by State Department. We haven't heard from my sister yet. You know, we haven't heard from Hillary.
Right.
What's that about?
Right.
Everybody put their 2 cents in. We heard from people on the plane, but we haven't heard from Hillary.
Right.
Now, let's go back. If the father, I have 10 children, right?
Right.
12 grandchildren. If I had a child in England, or a grandchild in England, and all of them, they disappeared, the first thing I'd do is go to the British embassy.
Right.
And ask
That's them. Right. That's so, right.
Now, I'm not saying they didn't, but that's what happens when you give me the information you want me to have. What? You see, I had a daughter that got 2 PhDs from the London School of Economics.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to my wife, Lil, I said, you know, let me see how it works. Suppose they would have taken Michelle and manipulated her, called mind control, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And this happened because somebody on that plane said he looked like a zombie. Did you see that? That's mind
mm-hmm.
control, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he don't know nothing about what's going on. They just take you, and now all at once, Britain kick him out because they done their job. Now the CIA and the FBI, and the FBI is way down on the pecking order. And British intelligence, they manipulating the whole thing. Now we see information coming out and coming out and coming out, and nobody's making sense. First, how come the number one target need to be, who was that Indian man those folks saw him with?
Right.
Who was the supervisor that permitted him to get on that plane?
Right.
Huh? Who was that, right? And so when you stop and think about all of this here, and now we got it in our court now, and now it's up to Obama. And he got to deal with a whole... See, it ain't about racism. It's about white supremacy.
Mm.
Do you know, it ain't about Fox News, man. Do you know how many people on them talk shows, those hosts, refer to President Obama as Obama?
They always do it. In fact, the last time I was on there, I corrected them and said, look, his name is President
Obama. They never called Bush. But look, when Bush was president, George, Condoleezza Rice had more PhDs than his whole cabinet.
Yep.
They called her Condi.
Yep.
She didn't see right. nothing wrong with it.
Yep.
Most black folks I know, they never called Madeleine Albright Maddie.
That's right.
They never called Janet Reno Janny.
That's right.
Huh? So when you stop and think about, I mean, for them to call her Condi, there's a soda pop. Y'all need to go buy one. I don't advocate soda, so don't drink it. Go get you a bottle of Dr. Pepper. It's darker than her. And they call it Dr. Pepper. And if you go to the grocery store today and say, give me one of them peppers, they give you a chili pepper.
Oh,
you have to
man.
Ask for it by its title. So now what he needs to be doing, and it's hard to do, because a lot of people there are surrounded by him. They government. It's a game they play. Huh?
Not my blackness, fool. If you go out to the lake where crabs hang out, they not pulling on one another. Don't mix up the hot water with my blackness. Okay? You black folks sitting on this campus, walking down the street, not calling one another bitches and hoes, but ain't saying hello. Ain't smart. What kind of fool is you? Somewhere when you understand what the problem is. We're the only people in the world that let people come in and deal with the problem is not qualified. Just cause you black or you got some money or you got some damn degree. Them Nazis that surrounded Hitler, all of them had graduated. You can't be a priest or a nun without finished college. Them Baptist ministers that don't even know how to spell PhD ain't never ripped off my little son's booty like them college graduates. And they decided the number one song was "It's Hard Out Here Being a Pimp," and y'all didn't shut them down. Exactly. I'm so I wrote this song the next day. It's hard out here being a pedophile priest. Especially when the altar boy call the police. Now you're going to jail where the brothers don't use no grease. My mama has little legs, she worked all day long. Whole lot, see, I was born before welfare, and I don't know what you black folk got against welfare. How can you hate free money and then run play the lottery every day? I got a company, Sydney got a company. Some of these folks sitting up here got companies. Let me tell you what welfare is. I can take a hoe all the way around the world, and as long as I call that hoe my secretary, it's a tax write-off. You know, crazy. My oldest son called me. Serious wisdom. Dad, you got to come to Dallas. I'm cracked out. I can't help you, son. The first thing y'all got to do is get off that emotional crap. I can't help you, son. I never smoke a reefer. And don't call your mama. She never drink a beer. Dad, you go all over the world helping people. Son, if you had a brain tumor, would you ask me to come to Dallas and cut your head off? He's a gangster. My mama worked hard, sold lunches, worked for the white folks. We never saw her till late at night. And on Christmas, we woke up and all six of us had our gifts under the tree. Huh? There's something about a cheat gift. They look just as good as a shirt from Neiman Marcus till you wash them. Nothing like the joy of opening up your gift Christmas morning. And then a mama so ignorant and out of it, she give credit to a white man that hate niggas. Huh? And y'all think the problem is these rappers? My mama! Huh? Love me! And let a white man choose back to get down the chimney.
Exactly.
You crazy? It's a game. I go to China, go to the Christian section. Jesus Christ, the Chinese. Go to Japan, Jesus Christ, the Japanese. Go to Brazil, Jesus Christ, the Brazil. Come to America and go to my black church, and it's a white man, and that don't bother from over there. All of them. A white folks who said the nigga that killed Christ, he an Arab Jew, and that don't bother you. So James, you crazy. And how can I come and talk to your children about bitches and hoes? And I, as a black man, don't push it, stand on the corner. And my 9-year-old, my 5-year-old got the passing to go to school. My grandmother got the passing to go to the store to get her office. See, what y'all doing is taking the cheap way out. You niggas will go all the way to Iraq, kill people. And you can't even spell their name and let niggas sell dope on your corner. If they bad, tell them to go out in the white neighborhood and sell dope. This is what we're talking about. When y'all stop playing games, call me. Thank you. This is game. Let me close with this. How come with the thousands of black cops in America, you ain't never picked up the paper, turn on TV or the news, and see white folk crying because this black cop shot my loved one in the back of the head?
Yes, sir.
Because he thought cell phone was a gun. How come you don't see that? You think black cops is more spiritual? You think better qualified? No. They got enough sense to know that white folks ain't gonna tolerate it.
Yep, exactly.
And the only reason they do to us what they do, cause you tolerate it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not telling you don't chastise these younger, but I ain't seeing you chastise the police. And one thing about these white cops, they got a sixth sense. They know you black men. They know you ain't no punks. You got your little degree, you ain't no thugs in your spirit. What do I mean by that? How many of you black folks in here could come up here and testify of how many black folks you know that a white cop came through the neighborhood and took his nightstick and broke your headlines out? They know not to mess with your car, nigga, but they can kill your mama, your baby, your grandmother, and you. But if they mess with your car, the fight is on. What kind of fool is you? Say, I'm gonna thank you, Mr. Somewhere. We're gonna come back to you.
Folks out here, let me tell you, I'm the one released the pictures with Ron Brown, who was Secretary of Commerce.
And you were the guy that made them admit, they called you a conspiracy theorist, that the head coroner at the Air Force, a colonel, said he had a bullet hole in his head, and others did. We know they had special forces on board. They killed everybody, blew the hatch, and he lowed out. Go ahead.
Well, here's what happened. They couldn't deny it because the people that did the autopsy brought the pictures to me.
That's right.
And so I'm saying we have outlets now. But let me just tell you one thing. Is your mother alive?
Yes.
All right. If you walked in the house and your mother was on the phone and you said, who are you talking to? She said, I just dialed 911. What kind of look do you think you would have on your face?
Shock.
All right. Anytime you say 911, that tells the brain to be scared. So, of course,
they pick 911 as a psyop and as a calling card.
That's right. But remember, in America, we never use a number for the month. We say Halloween is October 31st. Christmas is December 25th. We use a number for the first time because they have done the research and know every time you say that what happens.
And the subconscious message exactly is double fold. You call 911 for help, but the 911 is the government's number, and that's why Fox TV 6 months before put out an episode where the government runs a drill so the rest of the government stands down to fly a hijacked jet by remote control into the World Trade Center to then blame it on Afghanistan. Psychology shows that serial killers like to play games and let
that's
you know
right.
what they're doing.
Well, let me just say this to you here. Because you know so much about the news media. If you was working for NBC, right, and on September the 11th, you witnessed, you're the one that had the video camera that took that second building being hit, right?
Yes.
You would want a Pulitzer Prize, okay? Your name would be world-renowned, and you would get $40,000 a week. How come we don't know who took that picture? How come one of the most famous pictures in the history of the planet, how come nobody knows the name of the person that took that picture? And so you see, they don't count on folks like us, like you, and people. See, there's a lot of people that know things, but they never had nobody to call. I know what you do. I know how many people call you. I know you got to sift through. You got to have fantastic research, because the government will give you tips to throw everybody off. And so you have to look through it and say, wow, okay. And so consequently, if you look at the fire station, which is a block and a half away from the World Trade Building, and that day there were 343 firefighters that died.
And hold on, Dick Gregory, long segment coming up. Sorry, that one was short. Dick Gregory is our guest civil rights icon, and I love the way his mind works, all these angles, points he's making. He's asking questions. He's being a skeptic. He's questioning his government, the greatest form of patriotism. We'll be right back with Dick Gregory. Stay with us. Dick Gregory's our guest, dickgregory.com. I mean, he's exposed it all, ladies and gentlemen. The murder of Ron Brown, the CIA drug trafficking. Now he's on 9/11, JFK, RFK, MLK. And we're going to definitely have him back up on a routine basis. We're really glad we got him on the show, because I've always liked Dick Gregory. I know that much of the black leadership are a bunch of paid-off foundation eugenicists who've done their job to make sure 51% of blacks haven't been born since 1973. And I want to bring that up with him before he leaves us today. Because, see, I look at a child, a black child, a white child, a Hispanic child, an Asian child. I may not like racists that are in all their groups that don't like me because of the color of my skin, but I love those children, ladies and gentlemen. And let me tell you something. I think about all those millions of dead black babies every day. But a side issue, that it's big, though, and I want to raise that later. Going back to Dick Gregory, civil rights icon, let's get in, continue with 9/11, your years of research, your main issues, why you're going on the hunger strike. Dick Gregory, you've got the floor. Break it down.
What we left off was there was 343 firefighters that died that day, not counting the one that was injured. So if you look at the fire station, the company that was one and a half blocks from the World Trade Center. So when they looked at the World Trade Center, because of the insurance company, there's 54,000 people that worked in that building. And so when you stop and think about with in the course of a day, 130,000 people would come in that building, not counting the workers. So if your smoke detector, the battery blow out at home, you go get another one. But because of the insurance in the World Trade Building, you can't just go get one. You have to call the fire department, and that company right around the corner would bring and come and fix it, and then they send you a bill. That company would go a minimum of 50 times a day to the World Trade Building, a maximum of 75 times a day, every day. The day of September the 11th, not one firefighter from Company 7, a block and a half, was killed or injured. Now, somebody got to say, wait a minute, if somebody knows something, all these firefighters come in and we got 343 killed, not common, and not one killed or injured in a fire station a block away. So when you start looking at all of these things that hang out, too, that building was built really by Rockefeller when Nelson Rockefeller was governor. You see, that area was the only area since the Depression that was an economic disaster. So Rockefeller decided when he was governor, he would ram a bill through to float bonds to build it. So he put it through. The bonds came out of his brother's bank, which was the Rockefeller Bank, the Chase Manhattan. So they built it, and it was like a white elephant. It couldn't take off. So because of Rockefeller's power and influence in the Republican Party and in America, they got every agency. Every agency in Washington, D.C., especially to rent office space, that's how they fill that building up. And so consequently, the reason the Port Authority cops guarded, and a lot of Port Authority cops got killed. Let me tell you, if there's a bombing today at the Empire State Building, the Port Authority cops have no jurisdiction over that because that's not a state building. Now, think about when that building was blown up, it had been sold. Leaf, which is sold. Now, think about that nobody's talking about. If you have a World Trade building that is owned and financed by tax money in the state, then how are you going to lease it or sell it to somebody without having a bid? How are you going to lease it or sell it to somebody without anybody knowing this transition that happened? And so when they took Selma and let him lease it for 99 years, that means that the federal government now has no jurisdiction over it. So why was the Port Authority still guarding that building?
Well, they were also running a drill that day of Tripod 2 of the towers being attacked, so they were using that to make everybody stand down. They also went on the loudspeakers and told everybody stay at their desk because they needed somebody to get killed that day. This is all on record.
That's right. And so when you stop and look, see, here's the funny thing. Everybody thinks, that Fox News is right and CNN is left. Let me tell you, at the top, all of them is the same. How come you don't hear nobody on Fox News talking about the Federal Reserve? How come you don't hear nobody saying what you just said? Is the New York Times and Fox News and CNN, are they that much dumber than us? When Kennedy was shot, his car turned down Elm Street. That car was not supposed to go down Elm Street. That decision was made a week before. Now, then if that car wasn't supposed to go down Elm Street, how did Lee Harvey Oswald know to get a job there if it wasn't coming there? So when you just look at the small pieces and you turn them around, the big mystery to me is with 54,000 people working in that building, and we know 3,000 plus was killed, X amount went to the hospital, you got 40-some thousand people that got away. How come nobody's never interviewed one of them? How come they don't say, well, on the fifth anniversary, we're going to bring the winners who beat it? We got 40,000 people that got away. How come we don't put them in a big football arena? How come it's such a mystery around the ones that got away?
How come most Americans say Building 7, what's that? And the news announced it had fallen in its own footprint an hour before, 25 minutes before. They said it's fallen from fires in its own footprint, a total collapse that had never happened in history. Happened three times that day, and we have the footage. Multiple newscasts, police saying, get back, they're blowing it up. I mean, and that building was FBI, CIA, Port Authority. That was their command base.
That was the command base, and that didn't happen until 5:20 that evening. Is that kind of scary? You know, we look at the top two buildings that fell. And let me tell you something else that you can pull up and look. The next day, that was on the 11th, 12th. On Wednesday, the San Francisco Chronicle ran a front page story where Mayor Willie Brown of San Francisco had been warned not to take that Tuesday morning flight into New York. Now, at the time, nobody said who warned him. We know now it was Condoleezza Rice. Now, that was a front-page story. Do you know no other paper ever ran that story? Now, you go back to that Friday, which would have been the 14th. They had another front-page story in the San Francisco Chronicle that said that ex-Secretary of State George Shultz had received information on September the 7th, that building was going to go. And nobody ran. Here you got the Secretary of State saying, yes, I had information, front page story in San Francisco Chronicle, and no other paper picked that up. You have put options and call options. Now, my grandmother wouldn't know what that is. That means that today you and I can bet that we believe that Sears Roebuck stock going to go up, and we can put $30 million. If it goes down, we lose it. If it go up, we got a gravy train. On the day of September the 11th, there were 6,400 people that had bet the day before that the United Airlines stock would go down. There was 6,000 some people.
It was triple. It was triple the previous record put option, not just on airlines, but against American and United specifically. And then it came out in German papers. Buzzy Krongard, executive director of the CIA, his firm had made the majority of the bets.
Well, here's the problem. In order for you to make a bet, they have to know who you are so they can pay you off if you win, or know who to collect it from if you lose, right?
Yes, sir.
How come nobody's ever brought those folks in for a hearing to find out? The other thing is, in your home state, when the astronauts, when they rocket blew up over Texas, remember that?
Yes.
And they was announcing, if anybody take anything away from the crime scene, that's a felon, because this is an open crime scene. And yet, here September the 11th, they took all of the debris, they carried it to a little mafia place in Brooklyn, that's what was doing the hauling, put it on barges, and then shipped it to China. And nobody's been indicted for interfering with a crime scene. And so when you stop and think about, you know, how they do it, and all of the papers we choose sides, this is a good paper, this ain't none of
it. But let's not forget who ran security on the World Trade Center, Marvin Bush's company, but his contract ended September 10th. But let's go further. Newsweek and AP reported Bush signed the launch order to attack Afghanistan September 10th, and they attacked Kabul the night of the attack. How did he have the aircraft carriers 2 months before ready? How did he have 44,000 U.S. troops in Tajikistan, Uzbekistan? How did he have his brother declare martial law in Florida the day before?
Yep. I mean, when you stop and think about, you know, it's so open and plain. But then I go back to what I said before. When you have a nation that's 1/6 of the world's population but consumes 94% of the world hard drugs, that's not counting alcohol, nicotine, and caffeine. And let me tell you something else, brother. Every 30 seconds you and I have been talking, a woman in America has been beat up by her boyfriend or husband. No Taliban. So when you stop and think about this country we call America the beautiful, there's a whole lot of things have to happen before this country gets back to be the beautiful country that we want to believe.
It's become America the Babylon.
Yes, yes. Well, I put it better one than that. You know the story of Simon and Gomorrah, right?
Yes.
If this God don't do something to America quick, then God owes a serious apology to Simon and Gomorrah. So somewhere, now here's where I fit in. I'm looking at this, and I'm saying, oh, God, when you take those, listen, we spend trillions of dollars a month for security. And you tell me some snotty-nosed punk, little dudes from a foreign country that can't speak English, most of them ain't never been to college, can slip in. It's just like the Mexicans coming across the border. Look, if you got Mexicans coming across the border, can't read or write, never been to school, if they can get across that border, well, what is the KGB doing? What is French intelligence in Britain? They're not doing nothing because we're not going to permit them to come across. So when you see these folks coming across the border, they're not coming across because they love America. They're coming across because they're coming over here to get jobs. And if I came to Austin, Texas today and opened up a liquor store and only sold liquor to 13-year-old children and down, if you're 13 and 9, you can buy whiskey. If you're a cop, you don't come and arrest the children, you arrest me. So why are we going to arrest the Mexicans coming over the border instead of arresting the people that's luring them over with jobs? And you do that very simple. If your company gets caught hiring illegals, you lose the right to do business for 30 days.
But they don't want to stop it because they want to drive down the wages.
I know that, but I'm saying the American people is bitter with the folks that's coming through for the jobs instead of being bitter. It's a funny thing about American mentality. We will always attack the underdog. Do you know how many people I speak to, man, is fighting for your life? Oh, man, look, can you believe he's taking on this and he's taking on that? One person with courage has always been the majority. And so consequently, when you stop and think about, and see, you're too close to understand your influence. I'm out here, I try to do 250 days a year. I travel 24 hours a day, and your name keeps coming up. And I heard this here. And see, it's kind of interesting.
when I go to a doctor, I trust that I thought my headache was a headache, and then you tell me it's a brain tumor. I don't need no second opinion. I trust you. Well, that's the way people feel about you across this country. They trust you, and so people who don't have the research and the finances to do the research, they pick it up, and they know, and then they promote it to their mother, to their friends, to their children. And so...
And well, let me ask you this question. I've now discovered from insiders that Glenn Beck is taking what Oprah Winfrey does and what I do, and he has a team that fuses it together and then puts a pro-torture, pro-war, pro-patriot act on it, and he's now copying but twisting. What do I do about that? Because I feel dirty that my message that I mean to be good and pure is being turned into a counterfeit.
Well, let me tell you this here. Let's say you own General Motors, right? And I go buy me a Cadillac and use it to stick up a bank. Ain't a damn thing you can do about it. You're not making it for me to stick up banks, but when I buy it, I got a right to stick up, use it as a getaway car. So it just makes us smarter and slicker and hipper. And so there's nothing you can do about it. But you see, all of this will be exposed. Look.
Well, Dick, stay there. Dick Gregory's our guest. Amazing. DickGregory.com. We're going to get into a whole bunch of other issues on the other side. Stay with us. Amazing interview. DickGregory.com is the website. Our sites are Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Dick's going to be with us about 20 minutes into the next hour. Amazing interview. I want to get into a host of issues. You know, we forget about Commerce Secretary Ron Brown. I mean, after Dick Gregory exposed it and the colonel leaked him the photos, I mean, they shot those guys in the head and blew the hatch, and Special Forces put on their mask, and then they remote controlled it into a mountainside over in Serbia. And they killed him. He said, if I go down, Clinton's going down. They said, you die. And they killed that whole group of CEOs on board that plane. They're not playing games. Just like they're stealing the death benefits of the dead troops, Bloomberg. Just like they're telling you DU's good for the troops. I mean, these are some cold, hardcore killers. People say, well, why are you still alive? Well, they may end up killing me someday. But the point is they know that'll make my message that much stronger. And they can't kill us all. Back when they killed Martin Luther King or Kennedy, we didn't have an internet. We didn't have tens of millions of people awake. We didn't have people coming together. Dick Gregory, getting into black leadership, because you've been there from the very beginning as a true leader, standing up against the oppression, you know, the modern slavery that was still going on, Jim Crow, all of it. But then I look at Margaret Sanger. I've done deep research. I actually sent off to the universities and got the actual letters, not just stuff on the internet, where she said, look, we got to kill these subhuman weeds. And we've got to pose as liberals. We got to hire black leaders. We got to pose as liberals. And we're going to get these people. And they have. I mean, 51% of black people that would have existed after 1973 don't exist. And that's why it's good that Glenn Beck, you know, had one of the nieces of Martin Luther King up there speaking about that. It's good that he's starting to be forced to cover that. So I don't, it's just that I know what's behind it. It's just to get our trust.
Yeah.
But, I mean, a brief segment, but speaking about the black leadership, the fake before leadership.
Before we go into that, let me just finish up my September 11th piece.
Yo, go ahead, sir. Ahead. Sorry, yeah, I'm ranting.
I decided, looking at the firefighters and the first responders running into a building when everybody else was running out, and just looking at this, 900 first responders have died because of what was in the air, and nobody give a damn. So I decided this September the 11th that I was going to go on a fast. My birthday is October the 12th, 1932. So I'll be 78 this year. In 2 years, I will be 80. So I decided that as of right now, I'm eating no more solid food until my 80th birthday, and fasting and praying and asking people around the world at 12 noon every day at your time, just tune in to a meditation or a prayer that the truth will come out. Now, the folks that believe the truth is out, then why not pray? Pray that the truth will come out. Those of us that know what the truth is, you'd be surprised. You see, these folks can mess with this, they can do this, but the one thing they can't do, on a clear night, look up at the Big Dipper and the Milky Way. They can't mess with that. And the same force that put the Milky Way and the Big Dipper and the universe together put us together. And when you tune into that type of power, the rest of the
my doctor been dead 30 years. He's 50. And so, again, that's one person. And let me tell you something. Brother Jones, when's the last time the New York Times did a front page story on you?
No, they've never done it.
When's the last time you had the cover of Parade magazine?
Never.
All right. I say that to say this. When the universe picks you, it leaves no footprints. It tells you you don't have to be validated by the Washington Post or the New York Times or NBC. I've got your back, brother. I have validated you, and that's all that counts. And let me tell you the effect that we have. See, we look at things, and sometimes we don't know what it means.
Look, this is so deep, sir. Stay there. 1 minute break. Coming right back with Dick Gregory. This is an amazing interview, ladies and gentlemen. Stay with us. Dick Gregory talking about looking at the evidence, the facts, but also going with your soul, your spirit, your heart, your gut. And I've always liked Dick Gregory. I can tell, you just look in his eyes, hear what he says, he's real. He's veritas. Doesn't mean any of us are perfect, but like King David, we have a heart that's real, that loves good. And he was basically getting into what Martin Luther King said about the universe bends towards justice. And it's what Victor Hugo said. No army can stop an idea whose time's come. And he's right. The system's trying to come in with tyranny because they know humanity's waking up. Recap what you were trying to say as we ran into that break, sir.
Yeah. First, the general that ran the North Vietnamese Army was named General Kiop. And he wrote a book 35 years before we went into that country. And he said something simple. Give me an army that's willing to die, and I will destroy any army that's willing to kill. And so I say this to you, my brother. Give me the researchers that's willing to die, not kill. And we will destroy any army. I had a guy ask me, why don't you have bodyguards? And I said, okay, let's say you're my bodyguard. How many bullets you got in that gun? He said, 9. I said, if somebody want to kill me, all they got to do is show up with 10 people. I mean, it's just the mathematics is not right. And so what I said earlier, I asked you, and I'll ask you again, have you ever been on the cover of Time magazine?
No.
Have you ever been on the front page of the New York Times?
No.
Okay, the universe says, when I pick you, I'm the universe. I'm the same one that put the whole universe. When I pick you to do my work, I leave no footprints. You don't have to be validated by the New York Times or the Washington Post or NBC. When the universe picks you, that's the ultimate. And when you look at it, let me just see, we too close to this. You know, have you ever bit your tongue, Alex?
Have I ever what?
You ever bit your tongue?
Yes.
You know how bad that hurt, right?
Yes.
Do you realize these young white children is sticking their tongue out, running 5 and 6 screws through their tongue, and they're not using painkiller? And we so busy laughing at them and thinking they're crazy. There's a universal law. When you start inflicting pain on yourself, then you better watch out because something's fixing to happen. And if you do the quick research, those of you just listening, and find out why the Chinese hate the Japanese so bad. Because when the Japanese invaded China in 1933, they gave the army instructions. Don't mess with the leaders. Find every young Chinese male with a tattoo on their body and blow their brains out. Because tattoos represent revolution. Okay? And so what I'm saying to you, when I was a little boy, if I saw somebody with a tattoo, you knew you was in the presence of a felon. Okay? Now, and finally, then we get back to your question you asked. A butterfly, that little precious, beautiful butterfly, can fly all the way across the Atlantic Ocean, can fly all the way across the Pacific Ocean, but the bald eagle can't make that trip. So don't let nobody lead you to believe, because I got a mighty army and the CIA, and I control everything, that they bigger than you. That is a game they play. You take a welfare mother that's pregnant. She can't read or write. When her 9 months pregnant is over, they don't have all the armies in the world that can come together and keep that baby in her. You see, revolution is nothing but an extension of evolution. Evolution is a gradual naturistic change that when it leads into revolution, that's quick change. And that happens when a mother gives birth, when an animal gives birth. And what you're doing, and people like you that have radio shows like this here, you're giving the folks that's sitting there waiting on that gestation, that 9 months period. You're giving them courage. You're giving them something that they can look at. People can turn in and listen to this show and then go back and explain it to people. The hardest thing in the world is when the CIA and these thugs have control and there's no other voice they can hear. You're damn right they start making sense. They make sense.
Well, that's why they want to start shutting the web down. Dick Gregory's our guest. More key info straight ahead. We'll also talk about eugenics with him on the other side. Stay with us. The government did a secret deal with major insurance companies to steal the death benefits from the widows of dead veterans. That's Bloomberg. Totally confirmed. They've admitted it. And they say they're allowed to. They tell you core exit's not bad for you. DU's not bad for you. Asbestos isn't bad for you. It shows you who these people are. They get off on being pure evil. And going back to Dick Gregory in our final segment, DickGregory.com's his website. I look forward to having him back in the near future. Dick, expanding on this overall issue, and I talk about this almost every day.
Sure.
I'm not bringing this up because you're a black man.
Yes,
But I've studied the globalists, and they admit they beta test things on disenfranchised people that can't fight back.
Sure.
And I go back to the eugenics development in the U.S. about 90 years ago, and they said, we're going to test it out on these people.
Wait, hold it. About how many years ago?
About 90 years ago.
Okay. You know why I'm glad you said that?
Why?
What Hitler was doing with eugenics. Eugenics was created at the University of Virginia. Hitler was using our book.
Yes.
That was his blueprint for what he was doing. Come out the University of Virginia. Eugenics. And they had it all put together and said, here's how we're going to do it. Now, if you Google Ebony Magazine, where Dick Gregory said, you know, birth control is genocide. Okay, now, I didn't just get on this bandwagon. You know what I'm saying? See, I'm not like the King girl who a bunch of conservatives went over and they needed a blackboard to sit here and he say, here's how we're going to finance this. Let me tell you, I'm a black man with 10 children. I've been known for years, for every 10 white babies that's born, 3 of them die at birth. For every 10 black babies that's born, I'm going back now 50 years ago. For every 10 white babies that was born 50 years ago, 3 of them died at birth. For every 10 black babies that's born in America, 7 die at birth. So it didn't take too much mathematics to figure out if this system can get me on the same birth schedule as a white woman, they're wiping me out. Okay? And that's when I said, this is genocide. They know it. My grandmother didn't know it. A whole lot of people want to have sex and don't want to get people pregnant. Now, let me just tell you how corrupt I am. I had somebody call me one day from Canada, and, you know, and they said, we'd like to bring you here $20,000 for the Father of the Year award. I said, well, I don't qualify. And the guy explained to me it wasn't a joke. I said, no, I don't qualify. I said, listen to me and listen to me good. I have 10 black children, which means the universal God had gave me the right to create 10 other gods. It didn't ask me what color was I. It didn't ask me did I have any money. It didn't ask me could I read or write. It said you have the ability to create another you. Now, 10 times. The problem is I never had an affair with my wife. To create new life, man. I was just enjoying myself. Now, what's wrong with that? I never bought a car that I didn't know the year, the make, the down payment, the monthly notes, the insurance, and the trade-in value. Now, when I, Dick Gregory, got to look myself in the face and realize I put more planning into owning a damn car than creating God's new life, hey, man, I'm the problem. Don't look past me. Every time I get on a plane and travel anywhere in the world for a peace rally, I pay tax money on my ticket, which they use to buy bombs and munitions to kill children and old folks all over the world. So when the bombs drop on my grandchildren, I say, God, just give me the wisdom and the strength to understand it's payback time. This is what this is about. But I'm just glad that on this side, see, I grew up, man, and I was born 1952. I'll be 60, I mean 32. When I go to the movie and see John Wayne, man, that's who I wanted to be like.
when John Wayne said, if you right and they wrong, get your gun and kill them. It's until I bumped into this movement that told me it's not about killing. It's not about this. Man, I couldn't wait to get in the army so I could kill me somebody. And let me just tell you something right now. If they, if what you're talking about the veterans, how they treat them, let me tell you Americans something. Anytime you can wave your flag to get your young men and women to the front line of battle, but can't wave that flag when they come back to see that they get the care, that's not a flag you waving, that's a rag. And the sooner you find out about it, the better off everybody's going to be. I'm so damn sick and tired of the people that manufacture the munitions and all the ones that make the money on war who don't send none of their loved ones. They the ones that profit. One day, when the decent people move into a position, we'll say this. Anybody that make more war materials, you can't make no more money than 10% more during wartime than you make during peacetime, and the profits will go to the people who fight the war. The profits, when you got a Super Bowl, the winner shares in the benefits, and that's what we need to do with wartime. So somewhere, when you stop and think about, you know, America will be a great nation one day, but it haven't been. And the reason Negroes were not able to play professional baseball for years because of this. When the people start coming from Europe to here, the Irish Catholic had to live in an Irish Catholic neighborhood. You know, we talk about the religion, how crazy it is now. I remember the time in Boston, you wouldn't dare say you was Irish Catholic in a certain area. You would be stumped when the Jews came over. And you see, we forget the Mormons because they rich. We forget what happened to Smith and them. The Mormons wasn't created in Utah. It was in Illinois. And the Christians ran them out, killing them. And the reason they're alive today, they ran into Utah, and the Christians say, I'm a Christian. They all leave them alone. Ain't nothing there. They didn't know nothing about minerals and research. And so when we stop and think about how vicious we have been down through the years, and those of you, when I listen to people talk about September 11th, they go up on the Indian reservation and tell them they didn't wipe out towers. They wiped out whole villages.
Well, Mr. Gregory, we're almost out of time, but specifically, though, on the issue of eugenics, you're absolutely right that more than half the black people since Roe v. Wade that are conceived or never born. But we don't see anybody, Jesse Jackson or any of these people, ever talking about it. I don't hear the NAACP talking about it. You know, if the cops kill a black youth, sometimes because they had to, sometimes because they're, you know, the police are out of control, there's a huge big event about it. But then if I was a black leader, I mean, I'm just a human, so I'm warning black folks about this, but I'm warning everybody because it's happening to everyone, but it's specifically targeting blacks. I mean, why don't I see more black leaders talking about that?
Well, wait a minute. Wait, let me back up a minute. When you see Alveda King, right?
Yes.
All right. Have you ever read about her in the New York Times?
I don't read the New York Times a lot, but...
Have you ever seen her on NBC? What I'm saying is there's a whole lot of black folks still out there doing stuff. If it don't run in the paper that white folks read, it's like it don't happen.
I got you. So you're saying the leaders we're shown are the ones that are bought off. We're not seeing all the real folks.
Wait a minute. All black leaders is not bought off. A lot of people out here is doing the right thing for the wrong reason. And so as long as you're doing that, and finally before we go off, let me just say this. If you look at a little flea, a little flea can jump 24 inches. That's in their DNA. But they've done experiments where they take a flea and put it in an 18-inch jar with a top on it. And when that flea jumps up and the head hits the top, that flea is not aware it's in a jar. And after that head hits for so many times, you can take the lid off the jar and the flea won't jump beyond 18 inches, okay? And that flea trains its offspring the same thing. So how long can we be put in a trick like we've been put in since slavery?
No, I got it. I mean, I'm not saying all black leaders. I'm talking about the really predominant ones they put out there.
No,
you're saying they've been put in a jar, so that's the only universe they know. They're inside a box.
That's all of us. Some of them know the trick that's going down. Some of them don't know the trick that's going down. But I'm saying what's happening today. You see, I survive on this country because I bypass all of that. I bypassed that. I said, well, you know, Jesse Jackson had something to do with killing King. Don't that bother you? I said, it don't seem to bother the King family.
I mean, they get along with it. They can get along with it. But eventually, all of it is going to come out. All of it is going to be this. You know, when you look at Jesse, Jesse had one of the brilliant minds on the planet. Okay? One of the big horrors to me since the Obama one, it messed up a myth in my head. See, I had been convinced that black folks thought all white folks thought all black folks look alike. I used to believe that until Obama become president. I haven't had one white person walk up to me and say, "Excuse me, Mr. President."
What do you, in closing, what do you, I mean, clearly Obama was financed by the same folks, and it's just being used as a way to divide people. They claimed it would bring unity. What's your brief take on Obama?
Well, let me put it this way. Right before Rome fell, they had a black emperor from Africa. You know, when you look at the odds.
Yeah, they had Africanus.
That's right. What is the odds that the first black president of the United States wouldn't have no slave king? His mama wasn't a slave, his daddy wasn't no slave. Okay, but one of the things I'm looking at, there's a whole lot of white folk that going crazy in America because there's a black man in the White House. Now, they won't say poor white folk, but I looked at the inauguration. I was invited to the inauguration. I didn't go. Secret Service called me and said, "Mr. Gregory, you on the VIP list for the Obama inauguration. What time can we pick you up?" I said, "Are y'all the same Secret Service that was in Dallas when Kennedy, when he got shot?" I ain't heard no more from them at all. And so when you stop and think about it.
You know what, Dick? I know you've got to go, but will you do one more five-minute segment with us to finish up on this?
Sure.
This is incredible. I could talk to this guy all day. DickGregory.com is the website. Our sites are Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.tv. And please remember, folks, that this entire radio show is supported by you when you support our sponsors and by the books, the DVDs, the T-shirts, the materials at Infowars.com. Dick Gregory's our amazing guest. Let him finish up on President Obama on the other side. Stay with us. Civil rights icon Dick Gregory is our guest. He's dropped bombshell after bombshell on us today. He says he's going to do a two-year fast, basically. And he's famous for fast, or he didn't take any solid foods. I guess that's why he's so healthy at 78. And I look forward to having him back up. He was bringing up some even bigger bombshells during the break, but he said, "No, I'll talk about that on the next show." And it dealt with Obama. But we were getting into Obama, and you wouldn't go to his inauguration. I guess they wanted to use you to put you up there, somebody who's real. I mean, I knew with his advisors and the same people financing him that were financing McCain, I knew where this was going. Same thing with Glenn Beck and Sarah Palin. And the liberals want to be conned by Obama. The Republicans want to be conned by Glenn Beck. But more and more people are not getting conned. Dick Gregory.
Well, let me just say this here. When you stop and think about, look at this. Do you know what a Confederate flag looked like?
Sure.
Okay. And the Union won the war. When's the last time you seen a Union flag? Think about that. That's very serious. This is the first time a war was fought, and 99% of people don't know what the flag looked like that the winners had. They've been playing this game for a long, long time. And 13 is an unlucky number in America. No place else in the world is 13 an unlucky number. You know how many black folks believe 13 is an unlucky number? Why is 13 an unlucky number in America? Because it was the 13th Amendment that freed me. This is how this works, man. They've been playing games for so long until you can see it and feel it. I can't tell you enough what you mean to, you know, you are the voice of America. People like you are the voice. And as long as you don't worry about what other people think about, because I went to a conference one day, some of the richest people in the world was there. Some of the most brilliant people. And I asked one question. Y'all are here from all over the world. Y'all got all the money you would ever want. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Make me a scab. Huh? When I cut my hand, a scab. You can make a nuclear bomb. You can travel from one planet to another. But you can't make a scab. Only the universal God can make a scab. And anybody who gets hurt or injured, it don't say that you go to Harvard, Yale, or Morehouse. It don't say how much money you got in the back. You got a scab coming. And once you reduce these thugs down to just mortal folks and know there's a universal order that protects you, that watches over you, and they ain't into no isms and osms. Look, you got a right hand and a left hand. For the next 2 weeks, put your right hand
hand in your pocket and survive with your left. For the next 2 weeks after that, put your left hand in your pocket and survive with your right. Okay, is Queen Elizabeth left or right? The people who run the world don't play that. Queen Elizabeth, and I tell people all the time.
No, they control the full spectrum.
That's right. And once people realize white ain't a color, it's an attitude. And if you ain't got some trillions of dollars in the bank, you can't have the attitude. And so Hitler didn't declare war on Africa. World War One, but Africa, it was Hitler jumped on white folks. They didn't make a nuclear bomb to drop on Africa. And when people start realizing that and start understanding that, and so let
no, exactly. You've got the tiny ultra elite waging war against everybody else, but they play the subgroups off against each other because the controllers are so small, they're weak unless they can play us off against each other.
That's right, and that's why they can never admit if they found somebody from another planet. They couldn't admit it. Why? If we admitted there was somebody else, white supremacy go out the window, organized religion go out the window, and the third one, which is worse than all, we become Earthlings. There wouldn't be a Chicago or a Texas or Ohio or Germany. We would be Earth people.
Where do you see, in closing, Obama's destiny ending?
Well, it's very hard to see. Remember?
I'm worried about Obama being the false flag. I'm wondering. I'm thinking they're going to use some nut to kill him as a way to really divide people.
No. Trust me. They were. You know, look, when you groom something, you don't take it out. And let me tell you. And if whoever kills the president of the United States will not be a nut. Please believe me.
No, I agree, but I'm saying they would claim that. No, I mean, I see the point you're making. So Kennedy was rogue, MLK was rogue. I mean, they go after who they don't control.
Yeah, and if you look at this guy who had your name, Jones, down in Florida, if we really stupid enough to believe that this little upstart punk that got a church with 30 people, name can come a household word in 24 hours, and the government's not behind that, then we all stupid.
Well, it's now come out, confirmed that the Ground Zero Mosque is CIA-funded to get everybody fighting with each other.
Oh, that makes sense. But why do we expect good things out of evil, huh? Here's the problem I have. In America, the church and the state is separate. You can't name a school, a public school. I went to high school, summer high school. We was the Bulldogs, okay? But name it summer high school. Red Devils, Green Devils, you can name it that, but you couldn't name it Jesus. So we live in a Christian society where you can name a school after the devil, but you can't name it after Jesus.
White folks in this country dirtied up the word black, not us. White folks in America corrupted power, not us. And then one day we come free. One day we come through with two innocent words, black power, and everybody go crazy. But had we said brown strength, everybody would accept that. Hell, we wouldn't be able to walk down the street without white folks greeting us. Brown strength, my brother, brown strength. Black folks took two innocent words, black power, and everybody went crazy. Say you no more tricks. We did not dirty up the word black. Angel food cake is white. Devil food cake is dark. Understand it good now. A little bitty lie is a white lie. You can't find nothing no blacker than a tornado until it gets ready to clean up the white lady's kitchen, then it's a white tornado.